Everybody find some chocolate at their seat. Happy Valentine's Day.
She has been so high, and I'm sure she was a
consent agenda.
We'll tell Dave he needs to replace every chair.
All set? Great. So welcome, everybody. This is a continuation of the Board of Selectmen meeting for Tuesday, February 14th, 2017. My apologies for holding a meeting on Valentine's Day. I won't share my personal views on the holiday so much as talk about the fact that everybody in the audience got a chocolate for coming tonight. So thank you all for being here and enjoy the nice chocolate. We'll continue first up with the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God,
indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You know, I'm sorry. I meant to kind of shift up the Pledge of Allegiance going forward. Every time we have young people here, from the Scouts, we should have them help us lead the Pledge of Allegiance. I didn't even think of that until I was started saying
it. I think they kind
of
did anyway.
I think they did, yeah.
So great to see you, ladies. Thank you for coming tonight. We started with executive session this evening to discuss contract negotiations, litigation, and real property. We'll move now to item two in the agenda, which is the public forum. I believe we have some guests here this evening that would like to speak to the board and to the town about some ideas they have. So do we have someone that would like to join us? Ladies, anybody want to come up and say hi? You're going to sit right here at our guest table. Okay.
You get more chocolate.
And they're going to hand something out. Do we have a troop leader here with us this evening? How you doing? Good, thanks.
Thank you.
And we are from Girl Scout Troop 65294, and we're working on our Bronze Award, which is focusing on the dangers of distracted driving in our community. We are working hard to educate people of the dangers of distracted driving and help them change behaviors to make them more attentive when behind the wheel. Our project rolls out in April, which is Distracted Driving Month. You can find details of our project in the handouts we gave you, but some highlights include...
We are performing research at various traffic areas in town to observe drivers, making note of how many are distracted and the various distractions, phone, eating, reading, etc. We will be creating flyers to be distributed in businesses in town to raise awareness of distracted driving. We will be having a booth at the high school in Fruit Street Field, encouraging drivers to sign the pledge to not be a distracted driver. In exchange for signing the pledge, the drivers will receive education materials on the dangers of distracted driving, a silicone bracelet with one of our two slogans, "Head and feet keep the road in view, and behind the wheel focus on driving, that's all," a transparent window sticker for their car, and our gratitude for helping us make our community safer.
We want to produce road signage that will be placed in various locations in town, like traffic lights, school exits, etc., reminding drivers to focus on driving and not to be distracted. To move this piece of the project forward, we need your help. We need to understand the parameters for creating such signs, understand the process for approval, determine the locations, and who to work with on the Board of Selectmen.
We will fund the productions of the signs and will work with the DPW on having the signs erected at the designated locations. Thank you for your time and your support as we tackle this important issue and make Hopkinton a safer place. We welcome any questions that you might have about our project.
Excellent presentation. Thank you very much. Well done. So take a minute and look up on the TV there. You'll see yourselves on TV. We're going to put you right there. Wave to the crowd. Say hi to everybody at home that's watching. You'd be surprised how many people watch this stuff. So great presentation. And what I'd like to do, although we don't typically kind of go back and forth in the public forum section of our meeting or have any debate, I'd like to open it up to the board to have it answer any questions they may have and perhaps offer some suggestions about some of their questions. Mr. Sestara, you want to begin?
Sure. I want to say what a great idea this is. And it's great that we have yet another group of young citizens in our town who care about the town so much that they're actually being active and trying to help out. So I certainly support this effort 100%. I'm not sure if I'm the right person to help out with sign design, but I'm sure that the board as a whole can either help you directly or point you in the right direction with someone who will help you.
We are likely going to delegate that to one of the folks that we work with. So hang in there. We'll get you a name here in a few minutes. Mr. Catino.
This is great. You know, we've had Girl Scouts come here with the Gold Awards.
Silver.
Yep. Silver and gold. Yep. So how many are involved with the Bronze Award? Is it a whole troop thing, or is it an individual like the Gold Award?
It's a whole troop, 10 girls in our troop are all working on this project.
Excellent. It's great because you know you have to delegate the work and split it all up to make sure it's all even and everything. That's great. I know you guys and you're doing a great job. Thanks for coming. Thanks for speaking up. It's an important thing.
Mr. Tedstone.
Well, thank you for coming, and you guys did a great job. This can't be very easy for you to come up here and read into a microphone knowing that you're on television with a room full of people that don't know you. So you've done a wonderful job and your voice was not cracking. You did a great job. You should be very proud of yourself for that. And much like Mr. Sestari said, I back you guys 100%, and if there's anything that we can do, please let us know. We'd be glad to help you guys out. Well done.
I think it's a great idea. It's very timely. There's a lot going on in Hopkinton, in Massachusetts, and around the country with distracted driving. And unfortunately, people get hurt when they don't pay attention when they're driving. And so anything that you guys can do to help us make our community safer, we will support 110%. What I would like to do is ask Mr. Kamalo who he thinks would be our best individual to spearhead this in town hall.
Through the chair. Again, to echo the board's sentiment, great job, perfect project for the community. Safety is our number one priority. We at Town Hall would really like to help you along, and so there are two names I'll share with you. First off, Elaine Lazarus.
I knew that one was coming.
Two questions. She will work with you in linking you with the appropriate town departments to help you along. For example, we may have, and this is what happens when you work with government, we may have regulations regarding the size of the signage. And there may be permits that are required in terms of where you actually locate the signage. We really want to help you. We want to make the process easy for you. So please, Elaine Lazarus in our office, and she will direct you to the appropriate departments. The other person that you may be working with is John Westerling, your Director of Public Works. He is the one who does most of the signage work in town, works alongside the town engineer as well as Mike Mensah, our highway manager. My message to you is this is a fantastic project, well thought through. We are at your service. Contact Elaine Lazarus, she will help you.
Okay. Anything else? Mr. Sestari.
excuse me, Mr. Chair, I'd like to make two motions. The first motion I'd like to make is that the board vote to support the effort of the Hopkinton Girl Scout Troop 65294 in their effort to put street safety signs in and around town as long as they conform to all the standards necessary.
Second.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second on the table. Typically, for public forum, we don't go down the path of sort of getting into the issue. I think for this evening's discussion, as long as everyone's good, we're okay with the motions and they're not out of order, right?
Right.
Everybody good? Okay, any discussion on the motions? One was for no fees, correct? Or part of that was no fees.
That was going to be the next one.
Okay. So we got one motion on the table to support the effort of the Scouts, Girl Scouts. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? That's unanimous and so carries.
Mr. Chair, my second motion would be for the town to waive any and all fees associated with this project that may normally be waged.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to waive the fees for permits or anything of the like that the town would typically impose. Mr. Kamal, are you okay with that motion?
Yes.
Mrs. Lazarus, okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? It is unanimous and so carries. Okay, ladies, thank you very much for coming tonight. You've got the green light to make our roads safer, and we look forward to your signs getting out in Hopkinton.
We're going to call you back for the traffic calming stuff that we were looking at EHOP a couple of last week.
And cookies.
Okay.
Thank you,
ladies.
Thank you,
guys. Have a great night. Okay, next up. Anyone else here for public forum?
Yeah, forum.
We do.
Lauren, are you going to eat these?
After this gentleman, is there anyone else here for public forum this evening? Good, how are you?
Doing great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is an agenda item.
You would join us at our guest table and...
Is this a different spot?
You're on the agenda.
Would you like to go off of them?
No, I think we can do
it. Okay, so this is in the consent agenda.
Yeah.
Why don't you make...
We'll break it up.
Yeah, we'll break it up.
All right, yeah, if you could just give us a couple minutes, then we'll come back to you on this one. Gotcha.
Thank you.
All right. Anyone else for public forum? Okay, seeing no takers, we'll move on to item number 3, which is the consent agenda. On the consent agenda, we have minutes from 124 and 13117. We have a parade permit for the Faith Community Church of Hopkinton that we'll get to in a minute. We have a town seasonal population estimate that we can talk about. We have to execute a deed for a gift of land, and we have the resignation of Kathy Dugalecki from the Personnel Committee. Does anybody want to break any of the items out on the consent agenda?
I'll break out number 2.
Number 2, the parade permit. Anything else? I think we should break out number 3 on the town seasonal population estimate, just so we can explain what that is.
And number 5.
And number 5. Okay, so we have As usual, we have our minutes on the consent agenda, and we need to execute this deed for a gift of land, but we're going to break that out because there's a separate motion for that as well. Okay? So let's just do it real simple. All those in favor of the public meetings, or the board will seek a chair, the board will seek a motion to approve the minutes from public session from 124 and 131-17.
So moved.
Second.
And a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Item number two under the consent agenda is the parade permit. Mr. Morrison, you want to join us at the guest table here for a minute and explain to us what's going on?
Sir.
Welcome.
Thank you guys very much. Appreciate it. So I'm with Faith Community Church here in Hopkinton, and we are hosting what is called the Global 6K for Water. So what it is, it's with a nonprofit called World Vision, and 6 kilometers is the average distance in the developing world that people need to go to get water, and that's not even clean water. So what they've done is they've hosted a worldwide event. There's going to be 500 sites around the globe where people are hosting these races. So we would like to host a 6K race, and all the proceeds go towards clean water in the developing world, towards projects in the villages. So with everybody that signs up, they get given a t-shirt as well as a race bib with a kid's face on it, and all the proceeds are going to go to that family and their village that they're living in. So we would like to request permission for the parade permit to hold this race here in Hopkinton. We've been in touch with the police department as well as the fire department to do all of the necessary requirements on our side of it.
So. Okay. Excellent. Thank you for bringing us up to speed. Mm-hmm. Any questions on the parade permit for Faith Community Church? Everybody good?
Yep.
Good. Mr. Kamalo, permitting team is good?
Permitting team is okay. We did not receive any adverse comments.
Okay.
With that, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the parade permit for Faith Community Church for a event to be held on Saturday, May 6th at 9 a.m.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. All set. Thank you, Josh.
Thank you very much.
Good luck at the event.
Thank you.
So that's a running event, Josh? 6K yes, running event?
Yes, sir. You can walk or we'll do chip timing, so it's an official race as well.
Cool. Thank you. Then on my calendar. The town seasonal population estimate. I'll just read this one out. Pursuant to Mass General Law, Chapter 138, Section 17, the board will determine an estimated seasonal resident population for the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission, otherwise known as ABCC, for seasonal licenses in accordance with the statutorily required method of circulation. The estimated seasonal population in 2017 is 15,048. Mrs. Lazarus, can you explain a little bit more what this is?
This is an annual form that the town completes, and the statute requires that we calculate it based on the 2010 census. The town has very few seasonal residences, so in a town like Hopkinton, there isn't a lot of change, but they're looking for communities that have a huge increase in seasonal population that may need additional licenses. So in this case, the population of 15,048 is based on the number of seasonal residences that was reported in the last federal census.
Which was 2010.
Right, the number of people we're assuming are in each of those seasonally.
Okay, any questions?
How many seasonal residents do we have?
About 141.
And
123.
This 15,048 is with those or without?
It's with those.
With those. So we're under 15,000.
In actuality, we have many more.
As of 2010.
Well, that's as of 2010. Right. Why do we do it annually if we always are going to use 2010?
It's an ABCC requirement. And those with a large seasonal population can petition to go through another process, but we don't have enough people to justify it.
Snowbirds?
So what would the motion be? Do we set what's the appropriate motion? That we set this estimated seasonal population in 2017 at 15,048?
Certify.
Yes.
Right. Certify. Yes. That's what the form.
Yes.
So the board will the chair will entertain a motion to certify the estimated seasonal population in 2017 at 15,048 persons.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Item number four, execute the deed for a gift of land. Mr. Catino.
I move that the Board of Selectmen vote pursuant to the vote of May 6, 2013, on Article 59 of the annual town meeting, and pursuant to Mass General Laws, Section 43, to accept by gift the following parcels of land to be used for open space purposes. The land in Hopkinton, Middlesex County, Massachusetts, shown as parcels 4 and 5 in a plan entitled Definitive Residential Subdivision Hayden Place, dated March 1st, 2012, J.D. Markdon Associates, 6 Wall Street, Hopkinton. Said parcel 4 is designated on the said plan as containing a total of 122,178 square feet of land. Said parcel 5, designated on the plan, is said to contain a total of 4,379 square feet of land.
Okay. We have a motion on the table.
Second.
You started with I move, correct? Okay. We have a motion and a second. Mrs. Lazarus, this is which
easy.
Piece of land, otherwise known as the Hughes property?
No, it's a small piece of land on the street. It's across from EMC Park, and it extends down behind McDermott Lane and connects to the school property.
Okay. Where that accident was.
Okay. Any questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Number five, who broke it out? Mr. Tedstone.
I did. Well, I kind of pursuant to how we've been handling these resignations is we'd like to thank Kathy for all her service that she's given to the town and make sure the letter goes out showing our appreciation.
Excellent. We will be sure to draft a letter and get it out to Kathy. The Duke Leckies are one of the reasons they moved to Hopkinton a long time ago. Ted and I worked together at Westinghouse Corporation way back and known Kathy and Ted for a long time. So thank her for her service. That's great. But we will get a letter out to her. We already have it done. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve the or accept the resignation of Kathy Duke Leckie from the Personnel Committee.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous. So carries. Great. Thank you. Mr. Catino, you have something? What's that?
No.
All right. Number four on the agenda is the 110 Grill request for a change of hours. Does this not have to be a public hearing?
It's not a public hearing.
Okay. Do we have someone here from the 110 Grill this evening? We need someone here to discuss this, Mr. Kamal.
Usually no.
Usually no.
Unless if there are any specific questions from the board. And in fact, we also considered that the request is in the context of a recent detailed review of the board regarding the hours for pouring licenses establishments in town.
Yeah, so I guess the summary here is that they're looking to open earlier on Sundays so that they can have a brunch, and they want to be able to serve alcohol at that brunch.
Let's do this, if I could. Let me just read this agenda item, since no one's here, but you want to keep going, that's fine with me. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a request from 110 Grill LS Hopkinton LLC, 1 Lumber Street, Hopkinton, for a change of hours to allow for all alcohol to be served at the weekly brunch by extending the initial time of service to 10 a.m. on Sundays throughout the year when permissible. Hours requested are 10 a.m. to 9 p.m. on Sunday. Current hours of operation on Sunday through Tuesday from 11:30 a.m. to 9 p.m., Wednesday to Thursday 11:30 a.m. to 10 p.m., and Friday and Saturday 11:30 a.m. to 11 p.m. So they'd like to change the hours. How will those hours fit into the new policy that we put forth here a few weeks back?
The request is within the limits set by the new policy. As the board may recall, the policy specifically calls out the following hours: Sunday through Saturday, 10 a.m. to 1 a.m., with different hours for Memorial Day and Christmas Day, 12 p.m. to 1 a.m.
And they're asking for it for this year because those hours don't necessarily kick in officially until January 1 of 18.
No, those hours are now in effect.
I thought we extended it to 18.
No, they came into effect this January.
Oh,
January.
We extended the permit fees.
Yes.
Sorry. I got you. Okay. Okay.
So this has nothing to do with the alcohol sales. This has to do with their hours of operation.
Well, and alcohol sales.
Alcohol himself.
I think we had gone through a couple of iterations. I know at one point we were saying Sunday was going to be 11 o'clock, so I was confused, thinking that they were coming here to open an hour earlier. We had discussed, we knew that Cornell's on Thanksgiving and the Country Club throughout the year, they do brunch. We kind of expected them to come and look for, you know, special dispensation, if you will. But to me, it seems like this is within...
If it's within the policy, why are we even having this discussion? That's what I'm trying to understand.
Right.
Because it's the law requires that they seek approval from the board if they are changing hours for this kind of an establishment.
Okay, I'm still confused. I appreciate your answer, but we put a policy out that said we're going to have these hours. They've made a request to be inside those hours. So why do we have to approve it? It's meeting the policy that's already out there.
The policy is a general policy. The board has the obligation to consider each individual applications based on its unique characteristics. Having a policy in place.
That's fine. This is news to me that all that work we do every year to set up the hours doesn't go away. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah.
Well, I move to accept the motion as written.
Second.
Okay. So we have a motion on the table to accept the hours as requested by the 110 Grill and a second. Any further discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So carries. Item number 5 on the agenda this evening is the East Main Street recreational parcel. As many folks will recall, Legacy Farms has developed a significant residential or properties on the east side of town. With that was a host community agreement, and in that host community agreement were a couple parcels of land that were going to be gifted to the town or deeded to the town, whatever the appropriate term is, for municipal use. One of them was a recreational facility located on East Main Street, just off East Main Street. And another was a piece of land that we were going to use for some maybe future municipal use of some kind, specific to a school or a fire station, whatever. I don't know what that was, but I think that one is still. Have we accepted that land yet?
Yes.
We have? Okay, so we have that. Are those the only two major parcels, plus the open space, but it goes to a CR, or to a different entity? So what we're talking about tonight is that recreational parcel just off of East Main Street. You'll recall a few years ago, certain members of the board were advocating for a hockey rink. It's the same parcel that we're talking about now. There will not be any advocacy for a hockey rink tonight. But we want to figure out how we can get access to the land.
How do you know there's not going to be any?
That's right. You're on the board. Maybe I should be coming back up. I got two votes.
That's fine.
But we want to figure out access to that parcel of land. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Kamala and Mrs. Lazarus, maybe Mrs. Lazarus to go first and give us a little bit of background information on where we are.
And if this is okay through the chair, we also have a representative from the Park and Rec Commission who is here to participate
please.
In the conversation.
Dan Terry from Parks and Rec is going to join us. Thank you, Dan.
So the purpose of this parcel was for recreational use, as you mentioned, and it has been deeded to the town. And so the next step is to figure out what uses are going to be there and how the town will access the parcel. And to that end, Parks and Rec has been working on this for a couple of years, and they've presented this plan to the board.
So in, I believe it was town meeting in 2015, we approved CPC funding to do some engineering work for this. Only for the crossing over the wetlands area to access this property.
Which is right near East Main Street.
Right near East Main Street.
Right.
We've gotten to the point where Beals and Thomas, they drew a few different plans. There's one area that, or one crossing that makes more sense than others, so we've kind of zeroed in on that piece. The next step is to go ahead and apply with Conservation Commission to move forward with the plan. The question came up, is who controls the property. Well, Parks and Rec was happy to carry the ball to this point. The town owns the property. The selectmen are responsible for the property. So I guess what we're asking for is for the selectmen to sign the application that Beals and Thomas would move forward with for the for a Conservation Commission.
Okay, to set up and establish the driveway crossing to access the property for whatever we develop down the road.
Correct.
But whatever we need to get on the property.
There's no formalized plan for the property. It could be anything from just a trailhead to an athletic field and trailheads to this 26.2 foundation's been involved in talking about a museum at that location. So it's completely premature to talk about what we would ultimately do with that. We do know that the logical next step is to get access to the property from the street.
Okay. So when I looked at the plan, even a few years ago, and we were talking about other things, the access to the property really is only kind of in one spot, because you've got a stream or whatever that, you know, wetlands delineation or whatever they're calling it, kind of on the south east corner of the lot, uh-huh. Right? And on the left side or on the southwest corner of the lot, that's where they're looking to make this crossing come on off East Main and come in here somehow. So it seems logical that no matter what we do up, you know, on the property, we still got to get across, and we might as well get that piece going now. And we have the funds from town meeting a couple years ago, and Parks and Rec, who ultimately will likely be on the property and doing what that they're going to do for the community, has asked that we say, let's get going.
Good.
Everybody good?
Mm-hmm.
Any questions? Mr. Kamal, are we summarizing this correctly?
Yes, and for the public's information, the request is coming before the board tonight because the board has the control of the parcel.
Okay.
And so the request is for the board to authorize the town manager to sign the application that the Park and Rec Commission will be submitting to the Conservation Commission.
Okay.
Well, thanks to the chair, to Parks and Rec for getting the access to this this parcel. It's been a long time coming, and now we can finally start to move on this, and whatever it becomes, it'll.
There's a lot of work to be done before we actually have access.
But we still need to
seek approvals. But and I'm not sure how Parks and Rec was took it upon themselves to move forward to this.
Anything else?
That's it.
The chair will entertain a motion to authorize the submission of an application to the Conservation Commission relative to an access driveway to town-owned property on East Main Street, Assessor's Map R13, Block 8, Lot 3.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Kamal, are you good with that motion?
Yes, with a friendly amendment that the same vote authorizes the town manager to sign the appropriate applications.
What's in the motion, that the town manager is going to be the one signing the application?
Works for me.
That's it. Works for the second.
Yep.
Okay. Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, Dan. Okay, Mr. Kamal, you got that, and you'll take that ball, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Next up, we have the Master Plan Implementation Plan Review. The Board of Selectmen will review the implementation plan and the master plan for the purpose of providing recommendations to the Planning Board. Mr. Weissmantle, Chair of the Planning Board, is joining us this evening. Welcome, Mr. Weissmantle.
Thank you.
We have some chocolates there for your Valentine's pleasure. Feel free. Mr. Kamal, you want to introduce this topic to the community, please?
Yes, through the chair. In thinking about how to introduce this topic, I couldn't help but think back to the time when I interviewed for the town manager position in Hopkinton. One of the lessons I learned during the interview process, coming as comments from board members as well as staff, was that Hopkinton distinguished itself as a community that implements plans. And therefore, tonight I am excited to let the board know that Mr. Wise-Mendel is here to talk about the suggestions and proposals that the planning board has made relative to how the town is going to implement the recommendations of the current master plan revision.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Wise-Mendel.
Okay, let me start off with the master plan status. You saw a draft. Planning Board has now taken that draft. We've incorporated everyone's final comments to it. And the only thing left is the implementation plan. And I'm not sure whose idea, it might have been Norman's or Elaine's, that we take all the goals and make them an action plan and actually assign people to it. So it kind of came from the town manager's office as a good idea. We decided to run with it because it was a great idea. We had Elaine do a initial assignment based on her experience of who ought to be the person or which board should be able to be responsible for the item. And they're broken up by chapter. There's like the land use chapters on the first page. And basically, we're just asking, before we publish the plan, is that we fill in the timeline and fill in whether or not additional resources might be needed. And I don't know whether Elaine has helped you with the draft of those, but the planning board, when we were doing this, we got recommendation from our principal planner, which made it a lot easier for the board to go through it, and then we talked about those that needed to be talked about. And so we've got our kind of work done on the planning board. I'm doing a similar presentation to all the committees that are listed in here. Sometimes the fill-in on the timeline, it's ongoing. There are some, I'm going to say, motherhood type stuff that we just, as a board, do as course of business. And those might be just a timeline of ongoing. That was the word that the planning board ended up using that. There's others that you need a date. And, you know, we'll probably look at these once a year and just ask people how you're coming on some of these. Because the Board of Selectmen has a lot of ideas or a lot of items on here, the planning board last night volunteered that if you wanted to assign a few to the planning board, we could form a subcommittee. We got 9 members and a little bit more manpower, and then we could report back to you to help on the implementation, and particularly if there's some of those that have the word plan in it, we like those better than some of the other ones, like, you know, there might be a DPW related type of thing, but we volunteer to kind of help. You guys still have the authority to get it. We're just volunteering labor. So that's where it is, and we're looking to try to publish this in the next month or so. We lost a couple of committee meetings because of the snow and cancellations, but we want to get this thing done and signed and sealed. And if, while you're looking through the ones that have your name on it, if you disagree that that isn't our responsibility, we'll sort that out too.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Kamalo, having gone through it just briefly and some of it we've seen before and some of it is new. A lot of it is the planning board. A lot of it is the Board of Selectmen. Mm-hmm. Some of it, I think, is pretty easy. Some of it, I think, is ongoing. Mm-hmm. Some of it's on a high priority list for us, you know, and some of it might be a little bit controversial, too. So what do you think is the best way to proceed, given his timeline or request that, you know, we try to get them information, or not him, but the planning board's, you know, back within a month or so. Do we want to try and go through this evening and sort of go through it one by one, or do we want to chew on it for a week or two and then get back to him?
Yes. Respectfully, my suggestion would be twofold. If there's any specific issue that you see on the list tonight that you consider urgent and requiring the board's attention, you could point it out tonight and we can have a preliminary discussion. Otherwise, the plan is for us as staff to walk through the list that has been provided by the planning board and offer our recommendations relative to timeline and resources that are needed, and we can present this to the Board of Selectmen on the 28th of February.
And Jennifer would be in on those meetings with you guys as well?
Yes. Yeah, we will consult widely. We will work with Jennifer. We will work with the DPW director, the town engineer, and other directors who are impacted by the recommendations.
Does that make sense to you?
It makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah.
Are there any things that jump out at board members this evening, having gone through it sort of quickly there?
Nope.
Mr. Catino.
No, I'm just going to say downtown parking.
Really?
We've got a lot of them. It looks like 50-50. Jesus, something that's supposed to be a planning board.
Anything, Mr. Tedstone?
I'm good.
The only one that jumped out at me was the master plan for the Pratt property, because I serve on that committee as well, and I know that we're in somewhat of a hold pattern there until we sort out water questions.
I mean, it might be a couple years. I mean, we have some on the planning board that we're not going to get around to for 5 years. I mean, this is not a plan that you're going to get done overnight.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, it might be 2020, 2025. You know, I mean, some of these are long-range goals that are in the master plan.
I mean, a lot of them, like the downtown corridor that we're working at hard, and, yep, you know.
There's a lot of these that are work in progress type things, or things that have been kicked around for a while.
I saw the trails one there for signage, but
I
didn't want to touch that tonight. So, I think that the plan you've laid out, Mr. Kamala, if it's acceptable to the planning board, it makes sense to me. It seems to me make sense to my colleagues. Everybody good? But I don't see anything nothing really jumped out at me other than Pratt property. Okay?
Okay.
So we will go ahead and proceed on that path, and on the 28th, if you would be so kind and join us again, we'll have some specifics populated in the forms.
Great.
And then we'll discuss it more then.
Thank you.
Okay,
thank you for the chocolate.
Thanks, Ken.
Thank you, Ken.
Back on the treadmill tomorrow.
You're supposed to leave some for the other people.
Okay. Next up, item number 8, the Woodville Historic District Commission. The Board of Selectmen will consider reviewing and approving Section 19 Conflict of Interest Disclosure Forms for Woodville Historic District Commission members Sean Davin and Chris Waldman, who reside within the district. Are either Sean or Chris here this evening by chance? I don't see them. Mr. Kamalo, can you explain to us what's going on with this two conflict of interest forms?
The request comes to the board based on the recognition that the two members own property within the Historic District Commission, and that the commission may be reviewing applications pertaining to properties that are within the 300-foot buffer around the property that these two individuals own in the district.
Okay.
And based on our preliminary review of the request, we are recommending to the board that the board approve the request.
So you are recommending that we approve the request to sign the forms or to authorize the forms, correct?
Yes.
Why are you recommending that?
Two reasons. One, at this point, there is no identifiable financial benefit that the board should be concerned about. And number two, if there is an application that is within the 300-foot buffer, the individual members have the ability to recuse themselves from that discussion.
Will this form confuse them in any way where they may think that they don't have to recuse themselves if there's a direct piece of property that they abut?
I think so far our discussions have been along the lines that members process this request and complete the forms to acknowledge publicly that there may be a perception that the the individual members may have a financial benefit from the actions of the board. That in itself does not, and we've been very clear with the members that we've spoken with from other committees, and that in itself does not take away their responsibility to recuse themselves if they so find fit in cases where the applications that abut their properties.
Okay. And if the board takes action to approve the forms, in effect leaving the folks on the committee and just letting them go forward, with the understanding they'll recuse themselves if specific parcels abut them, and something goes awry down the road, we can always reverse this decision or address it at that time, correct? Does this bind us in any way to any term or anything like that?
To any term? I actually have not looked at that issue specifically. I may discuss that. I may have to discuss that with Ray.
It's very similar to what we're talking about with specific to the trails development that we're trying to do. See what I'm saying? So let's say 6 months from now, for whatever reason, there's a concern grows in town to a big level. Can we address it? Can we revisit it?
Yes.
As long as we can revisit it, I think it should be okay.
Yeah. My initial response was whether there's a term limit to the life of the form that the board signs, and I believe the answer is, I think it's live so long as they continue to be
on
members
committee.
Of the committee. Yeah.
But we can revisit that. We could revoke. Well, we could, if we approve the signing of the forms, which means we say go ahead, keep going, right? And then something happens 6 months from now, we could say, look, this isn't working, and we're going to have to do something different, right?
Yes.
Okay.
The board is the appointing authority, has the ability to do so.
Okay. Any questions?
I think, my concern is just similar to yours. Certainly, I don't have any problem with going ahead with this, but Mr. Kamala's terminology that he used in the first explanation was that the people have the ability to recuse themselves, and I just want to make sure that they're getting the message that, in our board's opinion, they have the obligation to recuse themselves.
I agree.
So we just need to make sure that message gets through.
Is that how it's been presented to them to date?
Yes.
Okay. Everybody good?
Yep, I'm good.
So the chair will entertain a motion to approve the execution approving and signing Section 19 Conflict of Interest Disclosure Forms for Woodville Historic District Commission members Sean Davin and Chris Waldman, who reside within the district.
So moved.
Second.
Any further comment or discussion? Mr. Kamal, are you good with that motion?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Please be sure that those volunteers who do a great job on that commission, the commission does a great job, understand that we support them 100%, but they cannot interact on anything that they are direct abutters on in any way. Okay. Item number 9 on the agenda is a comprehensive budget review for FY18, we have our colleagues joining us this evening, various department heads in town. Mr. Deegan's looking at his watch. We are spot on time at 7:40 p.m. Are we missing anybody, folks? We have all of our colleagues here.
Yes, please.
So if everybody could join us at the various tables here. We have some extra chairs there, and there's some back in the corner if we need to pull up any more. I think we are going to need some more. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Chief, could you grab a couple of chairs in the back of the, in the back corner there, so everybody has a seat at the table?
Nobody brought your Valentine's dates here?
So who's at the round table for the first time this year? Everybody's done this once before? Our library friends are new, okay? New library, new meeting. We got enough? So the first thing I'd like to do is if our friends at HCAM could get a big wide-angle shot of the room, I'd like to go around, and maybe not everyone will be seen on the TV directly, but I just want the folks at home to know who's here. And so if we could just do a quick intro of everybody and the specific department you represent, I think that would be helpful. We'll start with Chief Lee with the fire department.
Chief Ed Lee, Hopkinton Police Department.
Connor Deegan, I'm here representing the town clerk's office and elections and registration.
Good evening, John Westling, your director of public works.
Your director of public works.
The Ohio State.
You got to get that trademark, man.
I have t-shirts.
I'll bet you do.
That's how we are funding his budget this year.
Josh Corsetti, information technology.
Ken Wharton, Board of Health director.
Steve Slaman, fire chief, emergency management director, 2017 Bocce champions for the seniors.
Ooh.
He always gets that in. Cindy Chesmore, senior center.
Hi, Cindy.
Finance department, Chris Sandini.
Dave Del Torio, facilities and engineering.
Heather Back, an adult services librarian.
Deb Irvin, interim director of the library.
Lane Lazarus, land use.
Norman Kumalo, your colleague, town manager.
Okay, great. So thank you all for saying hello. Mr. Kumalo.
Yes, first off, I want to thank this wonderful team of department heads who braved the February 14th date to attend this meeting.
We have chocolate for all of them, so please do jump in.
Yes, thanks to Mr. Hare, we have chocolates.
If you have any extra, Brendan, if you need some, Brendan's got extras over here.
Good luck.
Yeah. And also, secondly, I also want to thank the board, as well as the department heads, for allowing us to test run this new approach to discussing the budget with the selectmen prior to the selectmen actually receiving the comprehensive budget and sharing it with the school committee as well as the appropriations committee. And therefore, tonight's discussion for the sake of the public at home is only focusing on the municipal side of the budget. The selectmen are not looking at the school department budget today. That presentation of the comprehensive budget will be made on the 28th, which is 2 weeks from now. I felt it was important that we have this discussion today so that at least we can at least have the preliminary discussion with the selectmen to identify issues that we may have to address prior to that presentation on the 28th. I also felt it was important that we have this discussion today so that at least the selectmen have the opportunity to follow up on some of the preliminary questions that the selectmen raised with us from 2 weeks ago. Specifically, what I heard from the selectmen was twofold. Number one, there was an interest in finding ways to minimize the tax impact in FY18. We have all had the discussions leading to today regarding the impact of the debt service on our budget in FY18 and how that is affecting the operating budget. In specific terms, we identified an opportunity to fund some of the ongoing maintenance and capital items that we have built, particularly over the last 3 years, into our operating budget. I'm happy to report to the selectmen that Chris and I also had a similar conversation with our colleagues in the school district, where they looked into their budget and identified items that are considered ongoing maintenance and capital items in the operating budget. We identified, I think, a list that amounted to approximately $630,000. Think of that in terms of how that impacts our Prop 2.5. 630,000 is approximately close to half of what is allowed under Prop 2.5 from year to year. Secondly, we also went back to the department heads to talk about the list of capital projects that we had presented in the preliminary budget. I can tell the selectmen, this was not an easy conversation with the department heads for the following reasons. Number one, as we have confirmed over the past years, the budget that eventually shows up to the selectmen is based on a realistic, objective, and thoughtful review of the community's needs. And so I can tell you, when I went back to the department heads and asked them to sharpen their pencils in terms of the capital project list, they were very convincing in their position that, well, Mr. Town Manager, as we have explained in our one-to-one meetings with you, we already did that. And secondly, there was a strong sentiment in at least having this face-to-face conversation with the selectmen, so that at least, as we've done in the past years, we give the department heads the opportunity to articulate the budget impact of not moving forward some of these capital requests. And thirdly, we felt what I took from the discussions with the department heads with regard to trimming down the list of the capital projects was the opportunity to be transparent in our discussions, i.e. have these discussions in an open meeting so that at least the public is also on notice that there are some of these priority projects that we may not be able to fund this year, and we will look into ways of bringing those projects back as requests for funding in the near future. So based on those three points, I can tell you this was one of the most difficult conversations I've had with this wonderful team of department heads. And they are here today to answer any questions the board may have. And I can tell you, and I say this with great appreciation for the effort that went into this, they came back with a list of projects that they felt could be moved forward in FY17, and also identified projects that they felt perhaps could be postponed to future years. So they were responsive to the request that the selectmen made. By way of how we organize today's discussion, with your permission, Mr. Chair, I think what might be helpful is for Chris and I just to give a very brief overview of where the revenues are, where the expenditures are, and then after that we start off with the, I hate using this term, but it's defined by the size of the budget. When I talk about public works, police, fire, IT, facilities first, because those are the budgets that have a significant impact on the numbers that you see tonight. We have tried, and Chris worked really long and hard on finding a much more efficient way of having this conversation, and he came up with, you know, seven departments on one day and then seven departments on the other, you know, to come at a future meeting. However, given where we are now, we felt it was important that since we're discussing the best ways of balancing the budget going forward, that we have everybody present for this discussion tonight. So is that okay with Mr. Chair, if we can start off with a big picture presentation first?
I think it's a great idea. We're set from 7:40 to 9:30 this evening to do this.
Yes.
And then we've got a couple. Wait a minute.
Yes.
No. We got a typo in the agenda here.
Yes, we do.
I want to clean that up first. So it's 7:40 to 9:30. Then the next one's at 9:05, 9:10, 9:15. So we're going to go back to the future or something. Some of this. I just want to make sure we're all on the same page here about timing and get with my colleagues. So is everybody good with getting out of here at 9:30 this evening?
Yes.
Are you good?
Yep.
Saying at the latest?
At the latest.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Given it's Valentine's Day and we have all these hearts scattered around in chocolate, We all want to get out of here at 9:30, not because we don't care, but because we all want to get out of here, including you guys, too. So with that, Mr. Kamal, if I could just make one comment. Mr. Ted Stone has lived in town his entire life. I'm not sure what year you came to town. I came here in 2000. Mr. Sestari, I think, came around the same time. As I look around the room, most of the folks that are sitting at the table, except for maybe Chief Slam and Mr. Weirton, I'm not sure when he joined us. Cindy's been around. But a lot of us are new over the last 10 or 15 years, right? Some of us in the last 5 years. And I've been on the board. It's my third term. It's his third term. We've been through some weird budgets and some tough budgets, especially during the recession. This one blows them all away. And it blows them all away because in the 17 years I've lived in Hopkinton, we've finished the new high school. We finished a new fire station. We finished a new police station. We finished a new senior center. We're building a new library, or basically, yeah, we're building a new library. We're building a new DPW facility. We're building a new elementary school. What did I forget? And we've bought probably hundreds of acres of land in the 17 years I've been here. Okay? So there's a lot that's gone on in the last 17 years. The taxpayers are really feeling it this year because of the three major projects are coming online, and we got to start paying the interest and the debt, you know, the principal against those projects. So the community loves everything that you folks do, and we represent the community. They love everything that the town of Hopkinton does in terms of services, but they have to pay for it too, and they don't love that. Nobody does. You guys don't love it, and your communities are in this town if this is where you live too. I mean, that's just the sort of the nature of the beast. So please don't take the pressure of the budget personally, and please don't take it as an affront to what your services that you provide to the community are. That's not it at all. This is about trying to make it work in a year when we're absorbing $50 or $60 million worth of additional debt. Okay? That's just the bottom line. So with that, Mr. Kamalo.
Yes. Let me draw the board's attention to the first page in the budget.
So where is that first page in the budget that you're looking at? Because he and I were wondering where this is.
I got an email.
Yes. Yeah, it's an email from yesterday.
It's an email.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Yes.
Actually, I'll use a big screen.
And Chris, feel free to jump in. I just want to draw your attention to the bottom part of the budget summary. I know the board's concern always is on the tax impact. With the budget numbers that we're looking at now, the levy limit goes up from 60 to 65 million, approximately. And the tax levy increase is 8.3%, and that's what Brian was speaking to. Net of new growth, the tax impact is 4.63%.
Can you stop right there? Please define net of new growth to anybody that might be watching.
Yes.
And we have our appropriations friends. You guys, if you want to join us, come right on. You good back there? Okay. Just want to make sure. Go ahead.
Yes. Net of new growth, plain and simple, think of the properties that are coming online, either the new developments that we have at Legacy Farms or the new building permit applications that we receive on some of the individual lots, either for single family homes or additions to properties in town. Plain and simple, that's the number that we refer to as new growth.
So 8.3% is what the current taxpayers would have to absorb if there was no new growth. With the new growth added in, the overall tax impact to everybody is 4.63%. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, so just a different way of sort of wording it.
Yes.
Okay?
And right. And I thought this was important. Everybody has been mentioning the impact of debt service on the FY18 budget. And so Chris said, Norman, what's the best way to illustrate that impact? He did the calculation, and if you take the tax levy increase of 8.3%, net of excluded debt, the impact of the proposed budget is 3.74%. The next line, we said, what is it that the board always looks at? The board normally would look at the impact of new growth. And we said, let's add that impact together with excluded debt. And that's the number that you see, which is the negative 2.98%. And then the biggest question is, if this budget was to move forward as proposed, what would be the tax impact on an average single family home? We're looking at $427. And that's the number I believe we...
And the average valuation is around $560,000, is that correct?
I believe it's much more.
More? Yeah. Over 600 now?
I'd say north of 700.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't think it's so. No. I don't think so. I know it was 567 or something like that a couple years ago. Maybe it's like six something. I don't think it's seven.
Yeah, you could be right. Yeah.
So, Mr. Camallo, just so I have it straight in my mind and other people can have it straight, the minus 2.98% number, that would be if we didn't have any of these other debt excluded projects going on, and if the increase in the projected revenue does come through, the actual impact of this budget on each individual taxpayer would be lower than last year.
Yes, factoring
growth is so strong,
right? Yeah, factoring in the other revenue sources that we build into the budget, like state aid.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Chris, anything else in terms of assumptions that may have changed from 2 weeks ago?
No, I think you covered it. 548,000 is the average.
548. So if your home is valued around $550,000, your tax increase is approximately $427 as it stands today. We've not finalized anything, but that's the number.
Net of new growth.
Right.
Yeah, that's all in, basically.
Correct.
$427. Okay. It's a lot of money. Because then there's houses that, you know, there's $1 million house, it's $1,000 increase. So there's some significant money on the table here. Okay.
Okay. And again, I thought what I heard from the board 2 weeks ago was basically to focus on two aspects of the budget. One, be more creative in terms of how we apply free cash. And I'm sure from a policy perspective that will also entail some extended conversations with the Appropriations Committee. And then secondly, there was an interest in focusing on the capital projects. So big picture, that's where we are. That would be the numbers that we just shared would be, you know, they illustrate the impact of the budget should the budget move forward as currently proposed. I can share with the board that there are still other opportunities. We're waiting to hear back from our school colleagues in terms of what capital projects they could scale back from the list that they provided in the preliminary budget. We also may have other opportunities to apply free cash to some of the ongoing work that we do through our Department of Public Works. For example, we have a commitment to appropriate a certain amount from the general fund to support pavement management. For this year, given the challenges that we're facing, we may use free cash to pay for part of that portion of the pavement management budget. There's also money that DPW normally would allocate for maintaining our culverts, and this year we may use free cash to pay for that. So again, the message here is, we believe we have come up with a reasonable response to the board's request that we identify some items in the operating budget that normally would not be funded through free cash, but because this is a tough year, we may consider using free cash to fund some of them.
So Mr. Kamalo and I spent 6-7 weeks, whatever the number was, Thursday evenings, probably six, at the school committee meetings when they were doing their preliminary budget work. And we sat in on every principal's presentation and every other department head's presentation with our colleagues at the school committee. And they went through a very thorough and exhaustive budget process, I thought. I mean, I'm kind of known in town as being a pain when it comes to the budget. And I think they were very, I know they were very detail-oriented in how they looked at their budgets, and very specific with the principals and with the department heads about what they were doing based on what they had last year, what they're looking for this year, and why. This was not a, okay, I had $5 million last year, so I want $5.5 million this year, and that's my budget. Not even close. I mean, they were down. They didn't count pencils, I don't think. Maybe a couple of them did, but they had to go into an awful lot of detail, and the school committee grilled them. And like what we're doing here, in our new room setting, by the way, I hope you guys see this. We're all kind of hanging out here together. We sat with the school committee at their table, and we asked questions as well. And I got to ask a bunch of different questions, kind of coming at it from my viewpoint, as did Mr. Kamalo. So what we're doing here is what they're doing over there, and then we're going to pull it all together here in a couple of weeks when we can get them. They weren't able to make it tonight for different reasons. But I think it'll be a very thorough and exhaustive process by the time we get it all, when it's all said and done. But it's happening everywhere, so... with that, why don't we get into some of the specifics? How deep are we going here, by the way?
Here's the message that I think we would like to share with the board, that to Mr. Hess's last remarks, we had a very detailed review of the budgets as they were being put together leading to tonight.
Our budgets here.
Yes, yeah. Everybody's budget. And so what may be helpful is at least for you to hear from the individual department heads as to what has changed in their budgets. And the focus could be on the larger departments. What you will hear for the most part is that the changes that you see reflect changes in salaries. There are a couple instances where we are also enhancing the programs that the town provides to the community, and we would like to share with the board the reasons why we believe that this is the year to make some of those changes.
Okay, and you mentioned we want to do 5 or 6. How many do we have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7... 8, 9 groups, correct? Is that correct?
Yep.
I'd sure would love to hear from everybody if at all possible. So, yeah. You know, we've been through this a few times, most of us on the board, and, you know, if you want to hit real quick what you see as your key items that you need to speak to, then we can kind of make our way around. If anybody has any questions along the way, we'll jump in.
And I can get this started. Town manager budget, 123. Overall change is 3.7%. Two major reasons for the change, in fact, three. One, we're covering additional expenses relative to the publications that we do in relation to the town report. And then number two, salary increases in FY17 were not budgeted in the budget, and we're now accounting for those changes. Materially, remember, those changes, for the most part, are covered by the compensation reserve, so the money is already there. And then thirdly, we are also accounting for the fact that we now have added Elaine to the town manager's office team, and we're really excited to have Elaine in the town manager's office. We as a town cannot provide all the training that she needs to move to the next level. And therefore, we are now registering here in some of the general townwide public policy associations that will help us in training Elaine to perform at the next level.
Can you speak to the salary increases in general across the community based on the salary administration plan and the numbers that are contained that would flow into a lot of folks' departments?
Yeah, what you will hear tonight are increases that the town effected through a merit system. We set goals at the beginning of the year. Throughout the year, specifically midpoint, we do interim evaluations. And at the end of the year, we do the performance evaluation. And based on the performance evaluation, we assign increases ranging from 0 to 3%.
0 to 3%, and there's a range in there?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Who's next?
Easy ones. I'll take the next one. Let me draw your attention to Youth and Family Services. Specifically, the budget is flat, except for two specific changes that we're proposing programmatically. Chris, the number for Youth and Family Services is?
5-something.
42.
Yeah? 42.
So, 4?
542.
Oh, 542, sorry. Yeah, here we go. Specifically, there are two programmatic changes proposed. 542. One is contract staff at $13,000.
What page is this, Norman?
Youth and Family Services is page...
Which column is this?
This is proposed for this year.
That's the change.
That's the change.
And that's page last
five.
Year.
Page five.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Okay.
Appropriation in 16.
Yeah.
Yep, I got it.
Yeah. Expenses. This is an interesting number. Expenses are going up by 292%, and here's why. The first is reflected in the budget. It's in the amount of $13,000, where we have identified an opportunity for the Youth and Family Services Department to expand its services by hiring contract staff to supplement the supports currently available to Hopkinton youth and families. Specifically, the department hopes to hire a contract worker in collaboration with Baypath Humane Society to provide weekly pet therapy services to town departments, library, schools, senior center, as well as to individual families on an as-needed basis. Two things to think of. The town has been looking at how we can better develop a comprehensive wellness program for the community. We have, in terms of the town's own health insurance, we have looked creatively at therapies that normally were not covered under our benefits package. And along the same lines, there are new therapy methods that the community has found. In fact, the social work community has found to be very effective. And animal therapy is one such opportunity. And through the works of the department, we have identified an opportunity to partner with a contractor in town to provide this service through a partnership with other departments in town, the library, the senior center, and the schools. And so we're asking for $13,000 to do that work. That's number one. The second opportunity, which I think is also a great opportunity based on a realistic assessment of the needs that are emerging on the ground, which relates to providing food security for Hopkinton families. What we are proposing, and we are very mindful in terms of how this would impact the FY18 budget, we're proposing that this be funded through free cash. Here's the program. We want to give the Youth and Family Services Department the opportunity to partner with established organizations in town to enhance food security. There are families that come to the office, are part of the program, that have identifiable needs relative to food security. And so we are hoping that we can build this program based on one, working with established entities here in Hopkinton that already do this work. Number two, we're also learning from the fact that currently we are providing such services at a very limited scale through private donations. There are people who offer gift cards to the department, and those are the cards that the Youth and Family Services Department is making available to families that are in need. And thirdly, we believe there's a real need. There is a real need based on the information that the department has collected. How much are we proposing? We believe we can fund the first year of this program through free cash at anything between $20,000 and $25,000.
Okay. Any questions on youth and family services?
No, I'd just like to make a comment. I think that both of those programs, you know, they sound great. I think that, you know, we certainly need to make sure that we monitor them. I think it's a good time for the town to start looking at finding new avenues to help people through, you know, whatever departments. But it's not always about improving trash collection or improving the roads. You know, a lot of times you need to get right down to, you know, the human aspect. And I know that from discussions that I've had with people, some of our neighboring towns are doing things like the food pantry, to a much greater extent than the $25,000 being proposed. I'm certainly in favor of supporting the $25,000. I'd love to see that as a starting point and see it grow if needed in the future. But I think it's a great step for the town.
Anyone else?
I'm good.
So we're a round table here. I mean, I know it's Denise's budget, but does anybody have any thoughts, comments they want to put out? Chris?
I was just going to volunteer to go next.
Sorry. You're going to volunteer to go next?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. We'll come back to you, Chris.
I can't stand the suspense.
I totally agree. I mean, I think something's going on in our world, and I don't fully understand it. But wherever we can help people in need, I think it's incumbent upon us. I do believe it takes all of us working together. And if it costs us a tiny fraction of money per household in Hopkinton to help those that are struggling, we should do it without a second's thought. That'll get me in trouble with some, but that's fine. I think we should go ahead and fund that as best we can. Anybody else? Okay, so Mr. Kamal, next one, please.
Anyone? Chris volunteer.
Anybody but Chris?
Oh, yeah, I forgot Chris. Jumping up and down over there. Yeah. Chris, come on, go ahead.
I think you had too much chocolate. The finance department consists of the accounting department, the assessor's department, and the treasurer collector's department. Accounting department is going up insignificantly. It's under 2%, I believe. There's no increases for any of our expenses, and our wages went up slightly due to our increases last year. So they were just based upon that. Assessors has gone up quite a bit. There's 30,000 that's added as sort of an initiative that we thought was worthwhile. I had the assessor come to me and make his case towards a different way of assessing personal property for our three large utilities in town, and it can have the impact of generating significant revenue down the road. So I thought it was worthy. Treasurer collector is actually going down due to turnover in the treasurer's position, as you folks are aware. So that one's actually going down. So there's not much in the way of increases in the finance department. The other thing I'd like to just address for a second is the debt service, which is a significant driver of our increases this year, as you guys are all aware. The only thing I'd like to tell you is what's baked in there is what everything currently we have due for 2018, that's pretty much set in stone. Those schedules, that debt has already been issued. Anything beyond then, you had to make some judgments as to what we were going to include from our capital plan. As you know, we have to be flexible, and there are certain times where we push things off to future years. Those kinds of decisions had to be made for future years. It was made middle of the road. We made some adjustments where we thought, but it's interesting to note that our debt service will actually, at the current rate, it will double in the year, pretty much double in the year 2019, the way we're going right now.
Yeah, and for the board's information, the information on debt services, budget item 700 is on page 6.
Anything else, Chris?
That's it.
Chris, could you just give us a 30,000-foot explanation of this? Is it a new methodology of the assessment?
Basically, there is a different methodology that you can appraise personal property of these utilities. It was discovered during a different kind of ATB case that we could, in fact, employ this. The interesting part is we had done it to one of the utilities. We cannot use that method unless all three utilities are similarly valued. And I couldn't go into the legal reason why.
How does using a different methodology cost us more money?
We have to appraise it. We have to hire the appraiser that'll go in and do this special appraisal. It's a different method, which is a little bit in a specialized field.
And what do we think? So is this a 1 year hit, or is it annually, or is it every 3 years?
Depending on the results of what we find, we can make that assessment in the future.
Okay. And at what point would we expect this to start paying us all these great dividends?
It's beginning in FY18.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So there would be an offset to this 30 Gs in FY18.
In increased revenue.
Yeah,
that's correct.
And we expect it. And we expect it to match this increase or more.
Much more.
Okay, thank you.
What I'm hearing.
All right. Who's going to sign that piece of paper?
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Mr. Tedstone.
Nope. I'm all right.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, he hit my 108% on the appraisal, so I'm good.
Anything?
Change in flavor. They are specifically there are two departments that are requiring.
Are you good with him?
I think we're good with Chris.
Everybody else good with Chris? Any questions, thoughts?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah. I think one way of completing the conversation regarding the operating budget is to focus on two departments that are requesting additional personnel. And I can share with the board that we really looked at these two requests extensively to see if there was any other way of approaching the demand that the additional personnel are going to address, specifically the fire department and the library. The fire department's request is specific to fire prevention, and I can let the chief explain that. And then with regard to the library, the demand is relative to the need to address the service levels that will now be provided in the new expanded facility. Who wants to go first?
Yeah. Chief Slam.
Yeah.
So, thank you. And I took this first budget that I'm working on as a personal challenge. I started looking under the rock, saying, "What can I do with this?" I went right to our mission statement just to kind of say, "Okay, where do I start with?" And I'm just going to read that to you, just to prevent life and property from fire, medical, and other emergencies through rapid response of professionally trained personnel. Effective code enforcement, and quality community engagement. So I think you remember some of my goals for this year were tied into that area too. I put that up on a board and I sat and kicked that around for weeks saying, where are our priorities? The growth of the town challenges us with pure manpower. You kind of learn from the Hopkinton Ashland that boots on the ground is a big deal. I also looked at our budget statement, and you were looking to try to hit something in the area of 2.5%, and I said, boy, this is going to be challenging. So what I ended up working in my budget is I said, we're doing good with the troops you gave us. The change in the public safety dispatch, the two people that we got last year, we saw an improvement in getting our effective response force to calls. It's not where I want it, but we did show quite a gain in delivering that service to the community. The way I measure it with a lot of criteria, we got up from like 50% range to like 80%, and it's just how significant that one extra body and meeting standards came in. I also, in the 1 year that I've been here, really felt the impact of somebody that didn't come through inspections, inspectional services, code enforcement, of what the new growth is doing to us in that area. It was, saying that it was overwhelming would be light. So right away we initiated some work with the building department where we brought in assistance from a fire engineer, and that was like one of the greatest quick decisions we ever made. It saved the day. The quality of what I've seen in code enforcement and inspectional services for the whole town was a big improvement. What's missing is the man hours just for our internal group to continue follow through with what the fire engineer tells us with what to look for. So constantly we're doing the basics of code enforcement and fire inspections right now. We're not even getting there when we talk about community engagement or prevention programs that are outside in the community. We're just doing annual inspections right now. It's so much broader than that, and we haven't even touched the iceberg. So I said, that's really going to be where I could, with that money, get the biggest bang for the buck for the community. So it didn't add the boots on the ground for the basic calls. That person is a person that we can use when we have significant incidents, so there's a positive on the operational side, but I still have some work to do there. So if you kind of, if that makes some sense to you, kind of what my general work was, the challenges that I also had on my board were the 28 square miles. Mrs. Cesari kind of asked about a second station. I spent a few weeks analyzing where are we on that. One of the variables when I told you we're doing good in effective response force that's missing is response time. I don't even measure them right now. We have one station. We have 28 square miles. It is what it is. You know, we have one company, basically, that's in the fire station. So it's something that you just can't impact right this second. As we look forward, and I started to talk to a bunch of the community leaders, we need to start to have our eyes out for a strategic piece of land. The Ashland-Hopkinton study mentioned to us that there, if Hopkinton was going to look anywhere, somewhere down by 495 and West Main Street, the growth that the information we got from Elaine that was ran through MAPC, that is going to be our next area. It's not too far away from when downtown is busy, so we can supplement back up to our core area. Downtown is located in a really good spot for the response right now for hitting the most people in a timely manner. We really got to look at that. I say that tonight because that's just one of our initiatives looking forward. I need a lot of eyes thinking about the right piece of land, the right piece of property, the right deal, if it's leasing, whatever it may be. So the key thing about the research was the right location is more important than anything else. If we buy apparatus and people and put them in the wrong location, we're wasting money. So those are the two main things. Other quick areas I'll say to you in my budget was just the general change in Hopkinton and its demographics, the highway access with all the work they've been doing with the toll booth removal and ability to move around on the highway. Some of the open space, water supply is still a challenge with a lot of our developments that haven't had water mains put in. Natural and man-made disasters and the unknown that we're working hard on most recently is the marijuana legislation. I just don't know what the impact will be. We still have a lot of research to do on the impact to our community and any effect it may have on public safety and services to the community. So that's kind of my short piece. The one position that has been added is to have a fire prevention officer in that main area. In the background, I still have a feel that I am going to need more personnel, but I want to work hard on what are there other options inside our budget. We're reviewing kind of the ambulance fund and maybe some work we could do inside of that. We still have some work talking with the people from Legacy and how some of the money that will impact us in the future, and I just think that's for a later date. It wasn't ready for right this time, so that was my evaluation.
Okay.
Do you need me to touch on capital at all right when I do that, or should I just stop at the budget part?
Stop now on the operating side.
Okay. Questions, comments for the chief specific to basically one additional fire engineer?
So, Chief, the FPO that you're looking to hire, he would or she would run the inspectional services side of your house, and they would respond to calls if it's a significant call. They wouldn't respond to the routine alarm investigations, ambulance calls, things like that, unless there was a need to staff the station. So that would allow all these inspections to go on as scheduled and generally not as many hiccups and rescheduling issues as you currently have.
Yes. The current load, I can easily go to two people all week just with inspections.
Yep.
We right now, I literally run the deputy and myself out, and that's taking away from what we need to be working on. It's,
yep.
And I envision it once that person finishes their training, and if there's any slack in inspectional services, I'm hoping to go far beyond that. But that's just the short thing, doing Legacy North, finishing up on the Muse. There's 3 years worth of hard work. I want to add in this community engagement, the work with the seniors, starting to just do more kind of code enforcement in an assisting way in the future. So,
and that said, will there be any cross-training of existing staff to take care of some of this, maybe during some of your downtimes, to allow them to go out and do some of these routine inspections awaiting an ambulance or a fire call or something like that?
My vision is I need the continuity of inspections, yep, to hand out to everybody. The part where I envision the staff coming in, and this is where I think we're going to get our real bang for the money spent, is that our existing staff can really get involved in the community engagement and the work with the seniors and the work with the school education programs, and that will be kind of our big push forward.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, this is one that actually impacted me just last week. The chief came in and at Golden Pond and observed a fire drill that we had and noted an issue that we had, and actually the chief and one of the lieutenants is going to come out tomorrow. And so, you know, to have this, I can see where it's needed, because, you know, when the brass is coming out to actually handle something that really is going to impact Golden Pond, at least lately. And I can see how it can help a lot of other community assets.
Our opportunity is something like Golden Pond. They have an emergency plan. They're doing some drills. And for us to integrate in and try to help the system fine-tune it, and have our people go down and get involved in. That's what I talked to John about last week. I go, that's what I'm looking to do.
Yeah, and we were just talking about all this net growth, and you know, it's real important to make sure that we use the net growth where it's needed. And you know, we talk about people coming to our towns for schools and everything else, but public safety. You know, when we keep getting awards for being one of the safest communities in the country and the state, and it's those are great things.
Okay. Mr. Sestari.
I don't have any questions. Thanks, Chief.
You know, we represent the taxpayers of Hopkinton, and it's as one individual that represents the taxpayers. You drive around town, and in 5 minutes, you see why we have additional burdens on our police and fire. It's in all our services, frankly, for that matter. But in those particular cases where public safety is right on the line, it's very obvious, and I fully support this position. Next.
The library is actually requesting increasing 2 part-time positions to full-time and adding a new 19-hour position with a financial impact of approximately $71,000, and I'll let them speak to the details.
Please.
Thank you.
Mr. Kamal, do you mind moving a microphone over a little bit there?
Yes.
And would you do me a favor of that plant? They're very nice. I love how they were set up for the. We want to thank the Girl Scouts for putting them out, but it's right in Mr. Kamala's face, at least from where I sit.
No, Chief Leak.
Yeah.
It's good cover.
We haven't got to you yet.
Do you hand it under the table?
That's good. I'm sorry, go ahead.
So you all know that we have the new library going up, and it's on the horizon, I think, and for all of us who live here in Hopkinton, and we're very excited about it. And initially, from what I understand, when we had library services on two floors, we were able to use the current staffing model that we have. Unfortunately, we're going to have a third floor, a very important floor, that we need to staff. So, and the other piece is that this library has not had a young adult librarian until this past spring, and she has been working 19 hours, and already since April, we've seen an amazing growth in the circulation of young adult materials and many more young adults coming into the library. So it's really thrilling to see this population being served. It's, in my opinion, a need in this community, and to bring that position to full-time, I think, will only be a positive move for all of us who are not only serving the population, but for the population itself. So that is position number one, to move it from 19 hours to 40 hours. The second position is called a senior library technician, which is a generic title that we've been using for a lot of the part-time positions at the library. It's going to be changed. But this individual position, which is at 19 hours, this person takes care of all of our invoices, helps with the budget, helps with reports, functions as an administrative assistant, as well as our graphics person. She helps with PR, and also serves on the public service desk in circulation. So because of that, we feel strongly that we would benefit having this up to a 40-hour position instead of 19. And the third is a 19-hour position to help the adult services librarian with reference. We don't have reference coverage in the evenings or on weekends. And with just one adult services librarian working 40 hours and doing a multitude of services and tasks, we really feel that we're going to need that person on the lower level, which is where the reference department will be. So, unfortunately, that's about a 17% increase to the budget.
Anything else?
Yes. We're also requesting 15% increase in our book purchasing line, which is equivalent to $4,027.50. Primarily to use for the young adult collection. It's growing. It needs to grow more. We also have pressure on our McGovern Trust Fund that we depend on for our library materials, for, you know, for books, DVDs, and CDs, as it's also used for technology and our network fees. Our network fees have gone up in this fiscal year $5,000, and it will go up again in fiscal 18 by $1,500. So that is a total of $18,761. $65,000 of that, will be coming out of our book budget. So I'm requesting that we at least make up $4,027. We had to take the money this year that was slated for the young adult collection and pass it on to the network for this increase in fees. So we then took some money from the children's book budget to supplement the YA budget. And so we're just kind of, as the old expression goes, robbing Peter to pay Paul. The other request that we have is to increase our supply budget by $466 because book processing supplies have gone up, namely the laminating material that we use for the paperbacks. So that would help. We wouldn't have to take it from somewhere else. And the same with a mileage reimbursement for staff. We're asking for $150 so that staff can be reimbursed partially for attending network meetings, which are all over the state, and for anyone that might want to go to a professional conference within the state. Let's see what else I can tell you. I think that's all.
Great. Thank you. Mr. Tedstone.
I don't have any questions. Well, I guess I do have a question. The part-timers that are going to go to full-time, mm-hmm. are those existing part-timers that are going to, that have
yes.
that said that they would go to full-time? And
yes.
once we bring on a full-time employee, does that, is it the same with one department as all departments where it's retirement and everything like that? Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
Well, this reminds me of building the high school, and all of a sudden you realize all these extra classrooms, oh, we need a whole bunch more teachers. And so we're going to get a new library, so we really should staff it effectively so that we can get the best bang for our buck. As much as, like you, I don't like spending money, but if we don't put in the right resources, we're not going to get the right return.
And frankly, we could be offering a lot more in our services and programming if we had a couple of more staff on board so that we could be open, you know, perhaps another 5 hours during the week and also be able to pay them for special programs that might be offered in off hours.
Yeah, if we don't have a library that's open, worth building it. That's
one of the thoughts we actually have for this new part-time position is we're going to have a classroom on the lower level, and it would be great to have a lot of classes happening in that classroom, so we're hoping that this person could be tapped to offer technology education from there on a regular basis.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Sestari.
What's the headcount at right currently at the library?
About a dozen.
I think we have approximately 12 people.
12 people.
But we have only...
12 FTEs or 12 people?
Oh, no.
No, only four, including the library director, which at the moment is not working full-time.
Yeah.
There are four full-timers.
We have 12 people who are... So four full-timers, eight part-timers. We currently have two staff who work Saturdays only, 6 hours every other Saturday. And two substitutes who help cover circulation.
About roughly how many people hours per week?
Yes, I'm trying to get to FTEs, not
okay.
bodies.
We've got four.
What was the question?
FTEs, yeah.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I think the same question, right?
Yeah.
What's
yeah.
Again, I think the bigger strategy picture is similar to what we've been doing with other service departments, where we identify the core functions and make sure that that service is available to the public
mm-hmm.
during the time that Connor was open for business.
Absolutely understand that, but I also, you know, remember a couple of years ago when Chief Clark was sitting over here and he wanted to add six people in 1 year, and you know, we're sitting here saying, well, you know, that's a 25% increase or, you know, 30% increase to your department all in 1 year. You know, do you have to do it all at once? So, you know, we're just trying to evaluate, right? So.
And I should also mention before, thanks to the finance department.
Microphone.
Thanks to the finance department, we are also looking at other funding sources for some of the expenses in the library.
Mm-hmm.
There are other resources that are available. We'll continue to do our research. We're hoping that that will open up other opportunities for offsetting some of the increases in the cost,
mm-hmm.
specifically with regard to the operating expenses.
Yeah, yeah. So I don't want to be mistaken, but you know, I absolutely support making sure that our library gets off on the right foot, but I just want to make sure that we're doing our due diligence on this as well.
Would FTEs just be our total number of hours per week that people work divided by 40?
Yeah.
Okay. We have a calculator up. It's 290 divided by 40.
Six. Just about, right?
It was 7. Oh, it was 240? Yeah.
291.
291, so 7-something.
7.27.
That's your current FTEs.
That, yes, not including our substitutes, which gets a little bit wacky.
Yeah, that's fine.
Right, that's the right. Positions is 7.25.
This would increase it by about 1.5, so probably looking at about 20% increase.
Okay. Anything else?
In which of these other departments do you think we should take this extra money away from?
He's just trying to start a fight. Don't listen to him. Sometimes when we get bored, we just start poking at things for fun. Okay. We're not bored. I'll just say we're playing around. I specifically remember at town meeting when we voted the library, the discussions were about additional staffing and additional resources and additional books, and we didn't really have answers. And of course, you know, people always ask, well, that's going to cost us more in operating budgets, and people kind of nod their head. But we didn't really get into it, but I know it was kind of kicked around. So it's out there. And I think it's understood that we've got a bigger library with more resources, and it's going to cost us a little bit more money to operate it, but we want to be prudent in how we ramp it up. For me, you mentioned the word return. And it's with everybody, with all of us, we all look at that. We look at the return for the taxpayer. I mean, return for all of us in the room. You know, we all live and work and operate here. We want to have a return on that investment. The taxpayers do, too. We're building a great library. There's going to be a great return on investment for the community. We got to maintain that investment by having it staffed appropriately. So, again, I think we need to be careful with how we do it. But if that's what we got to do, then that's what we got to do, and we'll support that. And as a taxpayer, as one that can be a pain at times about budgets, when you guys define $150 for additional mileage for folks to travel to get better trained, that's the level of detail you're looking at. I'm impressed by that. I mean, I know we're getting into the weeds here a little bit, but that's great that that's what you guys are doing. I mean, that's the job, and I appreciate you doing that. And the $466, I think it was, or 67 for additional lamination and things along those lines. And I can tell you that the schools, they got into the nitty-gritty of that level too. I was shocked, but that's what taxpayers like to know, is that every dollar is being watched. And if there's a return on laminating the books, spend the money. If there's a return on sending someone to training, spend the money. If there's a return on an additional person, spend the money. If you can't really define what the return is, whether it be in dollars return or property value return or sense of community return or whatever that return is, then don't do it. But I don't hear anything that doesn't speak to a return on investment for the taxpayers.
I'd just like to say that, you know, the library serves every age group in town. And it would be a pity if we couldn't have the downstairs of the new library open in the evenings because there wasn't anyone down there. They couldn't use the computers because there was no one to help or to monitor that.
How about volunteers at the library? That's
we have a lot of them, thank heavens, because we wouldn't be able to do what we do without them.
Okay, so that program will continue.
You know, it's true at the library. They're a long-standing dedication of a group of people to help us out and do it happily, free of charge.
Okay. Anything else in the library? Anybody have any thoughts, comments around the table in the library? Everybody good?
Just you know, to Mr. Tedstone's point, you know, when we're looking at these positions and we're seeing two positions being converted from part-time to full-time, you know, there are the annual benefits and then there's the retirement benefits, and in particular OPEB, which is something that we've been discussing and you know, I'll say struggling with, but you know, I think that we've been clawing our way up that mountain over the last few years, in large part thanks to Mr. Palaco taking that effort on. But you know, it's just something we need to be aware of. So every time we convert someone to full time or just add another full time position to the budget, we're increasing the responsibility, the burden, I'll say, you know, for the future generations and the future years. So.
Yep. Okay. Next department, please.
I think tactically, good story. Town clerk and elections. Town clerk is going down by 17.25%, and elections and registration going down by 52.57%.
So Connor's closing up shop.
Yeah. What's the return on
it? Been nice knowing you, Connor.
So
we're going to elect you, and you're not going to have anything to do over there.
So fortunately, there was a lot of places where cost savings could be found when I was working on this budget. For one, when it comes to personnel for the previous year, as you all are aware, during the annual town meeting, the salary for the town clerk was decreased by about $5,000. So that takes a bit of savings into the full-time salaries. And then the previous fiscal year was budgeted to, or this fiscal year was budgeted so that both full-time positions in the office would be able to receive the full $70,000 that Jerry Holland had received in the 2015 annual town meeting. So being able to bring that back down to what my salary is now, along with Brenda's current salary, has dropped that at a significant rate of over $33,000 for the salaries alone. When we go down to the expenses, I was looking into trying to see specifically what we actually needed to look at for the town clerk's department, because a lot of the extra supplies end up being used by elections, which can fluctuate a lot more. So I did go into increasing slightly with some of the meetings and conferences, with the idea that both giving myself additional training and certifications, along with allowing Brenda and a potential part-time position to have access to those kinds of training opportunities as well. So otherwise, it's pretty much gone down across the board there because of looking at the previous year's budgets and seeing what we haven't used at all over a few years and seeing where it can be realistically decreased. I don't know if anyone wants to ask anything on that before I go to the elections, but otherwise I'll move on to that.
Any questions on the town clerk's budget? Everybody good?
I don't think we want to question a decrease.
You can make it work? As long as it works, we're good. Elections, please.
So now with elections, there's a very evident reason for why that has decreased by $14,000. That's because we have planned significantly fewer elections for this coming fiscal year. We had four elections and one annual town meeting with a special town meeting in this fiscal year. That was a large burden on the elections budget and the personnel budget for elections. I budgeted for the coming fiscal year, taking into account the annual town meeting and election that we know is coming up, along with the potential for a special that could always happen. And typically does. If you look at most of the history and recent history in Hopkinton, there's usually at least one special town meeting that pops up. So other than that, everything decreased because we're not going to have statewide elections otherwise in this coming year. We will see, unfortunately, that number probably go back up for fiscal year 19, as we're going to have another state election year, as a lot of political activism has increased both in town and around the state. So we'll probably see a large turnout, along with the early voting continuing in 2018 fiscal year 19 for the state election. Fortunately, I know I spoke to you recently, back, well, not that recently, back when we were first talking about early voting, in the savings that can be found by possibly referring to the state auditor. And after review with them and other towns, they are going to be looking into funding some of the mandatory costs associated with early voting. So that will mean that we won't have as much of an increase over the coming years, but I know in the original projections that were in front of you for what other future fiscal years might bring, the elections budget kind of followed a similar trend of staying low, but it's going to go every other year up and down based on the number of elections that we'll have. Other than that, another thing that changed with the elections, so it wasn't going to go down quite as far, and why it's going to go back up is the part-time salaries had to go up due to the increase in the minimum wage, because all of our election checkers make minimum wage, so all of them had to go up a dollar, and subsequently the others had to go up a dollar with that was worked on with personnel and town manager's office to decide on what that number had to be. All in all, the savings here, hopefully they'll be pretty constant with slight increases over time in the town clerk's office with, as I said, it's going to kind of go up and down in the elections budget.
Okay. Questions, comments for Mr. Deegan?
Down again.
Makes sense.
Good? Good? Mr. Kamal, any questions for Mr. Deegan?
I can assure you, Mr. Hare, think back to 2009 when I joined the town and you asked that we reduce budgets by $1 million. Connor is our cost containment officer. That's his new title.
Excellent.
He makes it a point that every two...
You're welcome.
Yes. Yeah. Every 3 months he proposes two suggestions on how to reduce costs. He even has a suggestion in terms of how we're going to reduce the cost for producing the annual town report.
Excellent. Anybody else at the table have any questions for the town clerk? Mr. Kamal.
I think at this point, I'm looking at the time. I just want to take this opportunity to acknowledge Ed Wheatonen. This may be our last budget session with Ed.
Well, then let's grill him.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, he has, and Ed, if it's okay, I may.
Sure.
Yeah.
Let me just yield my time to the because it's far more important.
Yeah.
But anyway, our budget is, we actually level funded, we sharpened our pencils, and looked at some nursing services that we seem to be carrying excess money, so we made our cuts there. We are looking also at different initiatives coming up. Mental health is also a concern that we see in the future. As Fire Chief mentioned, also the marijuana, the influence that that will have across the town. I would remind the board, too, we've also tried to look at revenue enhancement, so our budget actually is less, if you look at it, because of fees that we bring into the general fund. So.
Okay. Any questions for Ed?
Ed, not really on topic, but you mentioned the new marijuana legislation, and I know that tonight there's a meeting over in Ashland about that. Trying to get towns to start discussing any possible controls that they can put on that. I thought I heard something on the radio that all of the permitting for sites for this are handled at the state level, and essentially control is taken away from the locale. Is that true?
Well, that's what we understand right now. I think a lot of that will be hopefully clear it up as the legislature moves forward with the Cannabis Control Committee, and we can kind of get some more insights as to what abilities the community will have to monitor and restrict or regulate.
Let's just hope they don't put the same people up from the Casino Committee on there, right?
Let's hope not.
Thanks.
Anything else for the Board of Health? Ed, thank you very much. Appreciate you being here tonight, and look forward to seeing you around for a little while. Mr. Kamal.
In fact, Ed has advised us that he will be retiring March 17th. So
March 17th?
Yes.
St. Patrick's Day.
Oh.
Now, a lot of people thought I retired a lot earlier than
Oh, okay.
I did start in Hopkins in 1980. You asked Brian how long I've been here. I started in public health in 1980 here. It was a part-time job, 12 hours a week. I was paid $4.20 an hour, no benefits. I left in 82 and then I came back in 2008. And it's been a very quick, almost 9 years. But I appreciate very much the support of the selectmen, the town manager, land use planning that we tried to work very closely with, and all the colleagues that you have in this room, as well as who've retired before I have.
Thank you. Thank you for your service, and we wish you the absolute best. And between now and the 17th of March, we need to have another conversation with Ed, right?
Yeah.
You left $4.80 an hour.
Thanks, Ed.
Okay, next department, please.
Yes,
we're going until 9:30.
Yeah.
I'd like to try and get through them all if possible.
Exactly. At this point, I think in terms of the operating budget, clearly, as you know, senior center, we've focused on implementing the strategic plan that we worked on 3 years ago. And now, I think where we are is Cindy. Feel free to jump in at this point.
The two major ones, the increases we would look for. Postage, we have grown by 50% this senior population since 2010. It's imperative that we mail the newsletter out. Not only does it tell everybody what's going on at the center, it informs them of changes across the board that directly affect them. And so that's been a huge increase, and that the way it has to be mailed also affected the postage rate. And we did a lot of work to make sure that we are getting the best rate possible. The other one is one of the food service worker positions. All the food service workers are paid by the Friends of the Seniors. And we'd like to see the town start taking over some of those expenses on a gradual scale. Because the Friends would really like to start doing more of the capital type of items. And, you know, it's integral part of the town, of our services. And it would be one of the four positions that we do have in the kitchen. And it's about $12,000 a year.
Questions for the senior center.
Through you, Mr. Chairman. Norman, how do other towns pay for their senior centers? Is it all volunteer? Is it like what's sort of what's happening here, or through charitable organizations, or do?
I will tell you that based on my experience working in other communities, this is an amazing model, and I'm amazed as to how the town has managed to fund the program the way it does, i.e., relying mostly on private funding. We do it so successfully. There's no comparison.
And there are very few other senior centers that provide a nutrition program the way that we do. And it's been a huge part of it and changed a lot of lives.
Anyone else?
My mother loved it.
Yeah.
Well, it's great because there's a lot of, with the seniors here, Hopkins is still a very desirable town, so hopefully their kids will stay here, and that'll kind of increase the donations coming in. But I've been there numerous times, and really it's a wonderful place for everybody. Between the veterans, I go there mostly for the veteran stuff, and I think you guys are doing a great job.
What's been really terrific to see are the new people that are moving into town. You know how difficult that can be, especially when you're older.
I don't know.
And when they find a home with us, they make friends, you know.
What's the starting age where people can start going?
Well, you know, actually, Technically, it's 60, but we don't card anybody, and we have people in their 50s. And
so it's not like AARP. I can't start going right now.
No. We have a lot of teenagers who volunteer, and all of our programs, if there's room, we don't care how old you are, you know, so we encourage those who are, you know, 40s, 50s, come in and take our exercise classes, because they usually turn out to be volunteers after that.
Yeah. Great.
So you can go and get carded again.
I haven't heard that expression in a long time.
I think it's a direct result of the growth of the town. I mean, a lot of what we're talking about tonight is the direct result of the growth of the town and the services that we're required in many cases to provide, or we want to provide in other cases. And I think, like, you know, with the youth and family services and with some other things we've talked about, it just makes sense to make this investment. It's a no-brainer, in my opinion, and I think we're obligated to do it as a community because we take care of each other, including our seniors. So,
and it's been wonderful to work with Youth and Family Services in partnering with the police and the fire department on projects. It helps build the community, the safety net.
Great. Thank you.
He is the bocce champion.
Yes. We're going to get a crown next year.
Thank you, Cindy. Mr. Kamala.
Yes. One last, I think, operating budget that needs your attention. The land use department. Elaine, do you want to speak to how we're transitioning the principal planner's salary to the operating budget?
So the land use department, there's no increase in headcount or services provided, but we are beginning to transition the salary of the principal planner from 100% funded by fees to having a portion of that funded in the operating budget through an appropriation and reducing the amount that's funded by fees. So we're beginning that transition this year. The position has changed, and it's providing a lot of services in the planning board realm now. So being 100% funded by building permit fees isn't necessarily consistent with what the position is doing. So we're beginning that transition this year. I tried to offset a little bit by a reduction in expenses, so our expenses are going down by about $10,000, and that reflects our completion of the street acceptance program. We had a 3-year program where we reached back and had surveyors surveying those old subdivision roads, and this is our last year of that program, so that ends, and we're reducing that amount out of the budget. So that's really the only change, just transitioning that salary this first year. And also some merit increases in the current fiscal year that are factored in there.
Anybody?
Well, so the only question that I have is, and this is not a personal question, this is emails and texts and phone calls that I get from the public, is when the assistant town manager job was voted down at town meeting, and then Elaine was put into that position. I mean, we know that's perfectly within the charter to do stuff like that. The concern is now that it's going to be backfilled. So this isn't we're not backfilling that position.
Yes, we are not backfilling the position. We're not.
I like how you go like this. Yes. Yes. Total politician. Right there. Yes. Oh, I said it right on camera. Yes.
Yeah. We are not backfilling the position. We are simply, I think, phasing the funding of the principal planner position as we told the town we were going to do.
Yep.
When the position came in, we relied on building permit fees. And we have also said, as a general policy, I remember my lengthy discussions with Ed on this topic. He may have disagreed with me extensively. Our policy is to make the funds that come in as revenues available to the general fund versus earmarking them to specific departments. So that's it.
I think whether my position had changed or not, we would be doing this.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So the funds that we have freeing up, because we're moving that principal planner into the operating budget,
those funds are getting spread out across the community, correct?
We're putting more into the general fund.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Has the planning board weighed in on this sort of transition, and are they okay with what we're talking about? I mean, that person, that position interacts with the planning board as well.
I know that she raised that at a meeting, but I didn't hear any negative comments.
Okay. All right. Anything else for land use and planning? Anybody have any land use planning thoughts, questions? Who's next, Mr. Kamala?
Let's transition to departments that have substantial capital requests. And good starting point will be, I hope, IT. And Josh, I should tell you, and this links with the discussion regarding the senior center services. I was visited by a wonderful gentleman 2 days ago, and his simple request was, could you please tell the IT director that we need new computers at the senior center. He loves being at the senior center, but half the time the computers are not working. So he's wondering if you could provide 6 new computers at the senior center.
How many more departments do we have left? We have 1, 2, 3, 4,
yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
And we have 20 minutes. So 5 minutes. Although the guy to your right probably is going to take 7, so you probably have 3.
Mr. Kamala, to your point, absolutely, we're looking for, from a capital standpoint, adding 32 computers, or I shouldn't say adding, replacing 32 computers in fiscal 18. That would be coming from capital money. So to stick to the operating budget, compared to fiscal 17, the IT department is asking for a net increase of $33,100. That represents just slightly more than a 7% increase over fiscal 17. About half of that can be attributed to hardware, specifically replacing a number of legacy servers that exist outside of our shared data center with the high school. A handful of new tablets, or replacement and or new tablets. So some of that is replacing exactly what Mr. Catino has there, which is so old it will no longer take the updates from Apple. And if you've looked at the list of how old their devices have to be to not take the updates, you know that that's pretty old. As well as adding a couple of new tablets for mobile inspections, which I'll talk about in a moment. And a small number of smartphone upgrades for roughly 25% of our smartphone fleet. The other half of that net increase can be attributed primarily to 4 lines. That is moving to a centrally managed antivirus solution. A number of years ago, that was removed from the budget as a cost-saving measure. We are using a free solution, so we do have antivirus, but it's not centrally managed, so we have no way to look at single pane of glass reporting or administration. It's like trying to manage, 200 home use computers that are all just doing their own thing. Adding a financial transparency add-in to the new website that we're working on right now. Going to an online permitting software. So this would, we'd roll out first. This would be for the building and land use building permits, as well as the ability to perform inspections mobily on a tablet, so the results are immediate in terms of electronic and available. And then, the hope and plan is to use that same platform amongst other departments. So the next two that we would likely look at would be Board of Health and the Fire Department. And then number 4 is providing town email addresses to all of the chairs of all of our boards and committees. So that's where the majority of the net increase of the $33,100 comes from. We do have our number of line items elsewhere in the budget where we were able to see some savings with contract renegotiations or paring down lines that we realized we could be more careful with moving forward. There are a number of other small increases, but I think that's the big portion of it. Okay. I want to pay for that money. I want to pay for that out of John's budget with the 3 minutes that I'm going to give him.
No problem.
No problem. Mr. Story.
So the, I'm sorry, the, was it 30, how many, 30, how many laptops or computers?
So to be clear.
Those are not in here.
Correct.
Those are in capital budget.
Correct.
That's just what I wanted to make sure of. You mentioned smartphone upgrades. How many phones are we supplying? Not just the upgrades.
All in, we have a mix of smartphones, flip phones, Wi-Fi hotspots, and mobile modems, the equipment that we have in all the cruisers, and the apparatus and ambulances at the fire station. And I believe that the total number there is roughly 80 devices.
80. And have we looked at just the cost efficiency of supplying the phone versus, you know, giving people whatever, $50 a month toward their own phone? Have we ever looked at any type of?
Yeah, so I have done some number crunching there.
When I say 50, I mean 30.
I don't know if you can do that.
You're even kinder than I, because I use numbers lower than that. But yeah, I have done some analysis there, and I think we could get that number lower. Mm-hmm. I think the challenges or caveats there are primarily around people using personal devices to conduct town
business,
and when you get into public records.
Well, depending on the situation. I mean, and I'm just picking Mr. Westerling out of the crowd. I mean, I don't think it's critical that DPW business be on a town line versus a personal line, as long as there's some reimbursement. I'm not expecting him to go off and have to pay for it on his own and all that. I'm just throwing out possibilities there.
Yeah, so I mean, in principle and concept, I'm all for it. I mean, actually, Norman and I have had a number of discussions.
All right, as long as conversations are being had, I know you guys will come to us if you find an efficiency that can be had.
In fact, we've looked at it in the past, and I'm hoping our new CFO may have a different take on it. We ran into procurement issues, i.e., town pays for a service that has been received, and giving out funds without a specific invoice was not advisable.
Yeah. I think there's some Mass General law,
but again,
procurement involved in that too.
Can I just add that I've been out of the IT business for a little while, but I'm pretty sure that the average phone line is about $45 a month currently.
That's the
government purchase plan.
Roughly, that is. Yeah,
so that's what the cost is right now. It's significantly lower than you or I can get.
And the other benefit there is that all those devices come with unlimited data.
Getting those for elected boards too.
In that case, I'd like to ask for $33,300.
Sing there. Okay, we all love talking about devices, including our kids, but we want to move on here. Mr. Kamala, who would be next then, please?
Before you write, any specific capital projects you want to share with the board?
The two capital lines that the technology department is looking for. One is that hardware refresh that we talked about, the 32 additional computers. And I see this as something that...
How much is that?
$35,000.
And where are those computers going?
All over town.
Okay. That's probably all we need to know for now. And what's the next point?
The second is phase two of the public safety security upgrades, which is for access control at both police and fire, and the consolidation of the video and surveillance cameras within those buildings onto a single platform that's capable of being integrated with the system that the schools have moved towards.
And how much is that?
That is $96,000.
$96,000.
Correct. And that would be that would bring us to the completion of the project. So phase one, which we're doing right now in fiscal 17, was $67,000. And at that time last year, we projected that phase two would be in the ballpark of $95,000. We were, off by about $1,000, but pretty darn close. So phase two being $96,820, and that would bring us up to speed 100% in both police and fire.
Okay. So we'll talk about those capital items, I think, when we get further down the path here. Anything else for IT tonight?
I think that's it.
Anybody have any other questions, comments for IT? Everybody good for now? Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Kamal, who's next? I don't mean to rush everybody, but I'm trying to keep us moving here.
Yeah. Dave, we always ask Dave to reduce his operating budget. You may want to talk about the three critical projects that other departments have asked you to perform, and these are critical needs.
Yeah, there's three capital projects that I moved forward. One was a fire department rooftop equipment and control systems to replace the existing system that's been antiquated. We need to have repair calls by week. We're up on the roofs, chipping ice off the denting units. It really was a phase two project for the roof replacement that was done 2 years ago. It was a project identified in the camp. The equipment is outdated. Damaged and just needs to be replaced. The total of that, we had a mechanical engineer originally do an assessment. He came up with a report in 2014. We had an architect give us an updated cost to that from with escalation and so forth, and it's about a $525,000 project. And that replaces all the air handling units on the roof, all the other ventilation systems, the thermostats, the control system. It really brings it up to an energy management type of system in that building that we'll be able to access, similar to what we were able to do now for Town Hall, Senior Center, Police Station, and we'll be able to do it for the library and DPW. So the other two were replacement of the generator here at Town Hall, which, as you know, it was not cost efficient to continue to try to repair. They couldn't find out what was wrong with it, so we need to replace it. It is outdated, identified again in camp as a capital replacement.
How old was it?
The Town Hall generator.
Yeah.
How much is it?
How old was it? Is it?
It's maybe 20 years old. I'm sorry.
A little more.
Probably older than that.
Okay.
And the automatic transfer switch is actually the critical piece is a battery. So a 9-volt battery dies, the whole automatic transfer switch will not function. So the system needs to go. Working with the town manager and Chris, we identified a different funding source as opposed to a capital article. We're going to do that this fiscal year. And the other one is the fire station. The boiler at the fire station is also at the main fire station. The last technician we had go down there wouldn't do the repair. He was afraid it was going to fall apart. So, and again, I think we're going to do that through a different funding source, through operating budgets and transfers, and possibly working with Chris, we'll figure that out.
Dave fell on his sword for those two projects. Those are not on our capital.
Just hearing that for the first time. So. But we're going to do those two projects this year. We're starting to procure for those. The operating budget, we do have a couple. We have a new line item for rentals and leases to cover some of the initiatives the town has moved forward with Park and Recs and with a parking lease at the church. We've been covering those with end of year funds. We just thought prudent with known costs to include that in an operating budget now as a continued line item. So that really hasn't been carried in my budget since it'll start next year. But it'll come down once a final solution for Park and Recs comes to fruition down the road, wherever that is tied in with the center school. Street or once DPW building opens up. And then the biggest, you know, we did have some savings in the budget in oil use and electricity use as a result of the solar net metering project, as well as, you know, the library getting rid of their oil. So that's going to be a reduction, but all the subtractions get overwhelmed by the increase next year. It's almost 50,000 square feet more than I'm covering now with the DPW building and the library opening.
So you built in additional square footage into your operating budget line, because I saw that go up.
Yeah, about half.
That's to tie into these new buildings?
Yeah, about, we did a very detailed, I don't take too much time, detailed analysis of all the costs associated with operating buildings, annual tests, elevators, generator inspections. Took half of that. The designs for these buildings include energy models, and those energy models project how much your utility costs will be for electricity and natural gas. And I used about half of that. So there is a significant increase overall. Well, I think my bottom line of budget's 16% or something like that. Probably 10% of it is, or even more, 12% is more the increase in electricity and natural gas for those two buildings.
So it ties into the common theme that we're talking about tonight. The town is growing, our asset base is growing, we're getting a return on investment with some major investments being made, but there's some costs that go along with it too. And I hadn't even thought, I was looking at your line items here as you were talking about the capital items, I was looking at your operating budget and going, why is that spiking so much? And there it is, so it makes sense.
But we are working with, through the town manager's office, along with the schools, there's another solar project that might be coming online, so we can maybe add the two new buildings under another net metering program contract, along with the schools possibly for all their schools. And we've been realizing, you know, we've had a full year and a half now with the other town buildings, and we do save about 30 to 40% on electricity, and we've been putting that into, you know, other energy saving types of projects in the town.
Elaine, for the record, can you please note I have no comment specific to the solar discussion series?
No. You just commented that you had no comment.
I have no comment. I'm not going to comment to you about my no comment. Anything else?
No.
I'm going to give a chief take. There's one more. The garage doors at the fire station. I'm going to give you a chief.
Why don't we just build a new fire station?
I just got to say, Dave has held us together in my 1 year. I got his crew with Mike coming down and Steve just to this, because I don't know boilers and rooftop units, and I'm watching repair guys go up and down, and $300 bills coming in there on a daily basis in there, keeping me from having to have one of those happen. So the garage doors are 20 years old. I had a cable fail, and when the guy came in, he said, all your cables are about to fail, but it's not worth the hardware. When they pull up right now, they have to try to hold remotes and make the doors close, and they're not closing. And the upgrade is needed. The technology, part of the security piece that Josh talked about, it can all tie together. It needs to happen. I know you're tight on capital, but.
Yeah, the doors need to open.
The bigger doors, it's not like they can just pull the latch quick and try to get it out either. It can literally stop a vehicle from going, so I mean, you have to grab another vehicle, and it's...
We fixed the roof, can't we just leave the doors open now?
I'm sitting there going, no more leaks, and then all of a sudden, this other...
I think the challenge with the fire station, for whatever reason, is everyone in town, a lot of people in town, they still view it as being brand new. Right, and yet we're every year for the last 10 years we've been throwing a few hundred grand into that for whatever reason.
Right.
I don't know what happened, GC engineer what, but
right.
That building in particular, for being a new building in town, we've spent an awful lot of money on it.
Struggle.
The senior center we built 7-8 years ago, 10 years ago now. I don't think we've spent a dime since we built that. So whatever, I mean, it is what it is, but it's frustrating for taxpayers to think of the new fire station as being this money sucking machine. Maintenance.
I can remember when they were building it, they had the electrical trench open, and we had a lieutenant there that was a cawdry old fella, and he didn't know if the line was live or not, and he went up and almost got blown right out of the trench.
This is a never mind. Okay, Mr. Cabal, who's next? DPW.
Dave used three of your minutes, though.
But, so you just lost all your time. We're getting a new building. Stuff, we're not spending any more money on it 10 years from now. What do you need?
So 5 minutes from 35,000 feet. Our operating budgets, which cover water, sewer, and highway, we've got increases in their contractual obligations to our folks in the collective bargaining unit, and there's some utility increases. To offset that on a major scale, we've got two major savings. One is the trash contract, the new trash contract that we have. Thanks to that negotiation and through the town manager, the first year we're saving some $40,000.
Is that because we don't have our new bins yet?
No, and the new bins will be coming out. They'll be distributed early March.
Okay. Good. Someone asked me about that today.
We just concluded our contract signing and negotiations.
You're ready for that one.
The second one, and before I mention this one, I want to ask in general, are we satisfied with the condition of the roads during and after storms? How quickly they're turned black? And
all good.
Okay. Awesome. The reason I ask first is that we have eliminated sand from our equation when we're treating our roads. We are treating the roads with pure salt. It's something that is done by the state and other communities around us. Ashland, for example. We have calibrated our trucks. We're actually putting out less salt than we were before. So we've got a savings of tens of thousands of dollars in the purchase of sand alone. Never mind, in the spring, we'll be able to sweep it, and the disposal cost will be much lower because we're not picking up tons and tons of sand. Also with our catch basin cleaning. So we're gonna realize
that's great.
Considerable savings there. Beyond that, we've got capital. We've moved $692,000 worth of capital from this year into next year. I'll touch on those very briefly. We had $290,000 to reconstruct the water main on Cedar Street. We had $33,000.
When you say this year and the next year, are you meaning FY18 and FY19?
Correct. Thank you for that. We've got $66,000 where we're going to replace a dump body on our water sewer truck. We're going to put that off. $175,000 was an update to the comprehensive wastewater management plan, which is identified in the master plan as a need and a need to reestablish or reevaluate the areas which we're providing sewers to. And the last one was $160,000 for which we're looking for a third sidewalk clearing tractor. The storm that we had Sunday into Monday took us 11 hours to clear the sidewalks with two machines. We're looking to reduce that so that we can have the sidewalks more clear, but that can wait until next year. The ones that we are looking for this year, we are looking for reappropriation of funds that we had $50,000 appropriated last year to look at a green sand pilot for the wells 4 and 5, but we no longer believe that that will be an efficient and effective use of that money, so we want to reappropriate that money for converting to potassium hydroxide, which will help us to pump water from wells 4 and 5. They have a very high iron and manganese level that will help us to bring more water out of the ground. And the other one is $1.5 million to construct the Fruit Street well blending facility. We appropriated $100,000 last year for the design of that facility. And what that does, it will reduce the level of manganese that's coming out of well 2. It's one of our major producing wells. Without that, we risk the chance of DEP coming in and telling us that we're in violation of our manganese levels. So there's that in the water side, those two items. On the sewer side, we do have $150,000 for a flow metering program. We have to look at actually inflow and infiltration, and this is a DEP requirement. On the highway side, there is a drainage pipe on Hayden Row right by the new school. It cost $135,000 to upgrade that and extend it. It needs to be extended because they are widening Hayden Row in that area for a turn lane into the new school. We're also adding a sidewalk, so that is necessary. We only have one vehicle this year, and it is the highway manager's vehicle. It is a 10-plus-year-old vehicle. It's got 111,000 miles on it. It is completely rotten underneath. It didn't pass inspection this year. We had to put Band-Aids on it just to get it inspected.
Is that the Black Explorer?
Correct. We have $1.65 million for the next phase of sidewalks, which put sidewalks down on Hayden Row Street to service the new school, puts them on West Main Street, puts them on Wood Street. The next item that we have is $351,000 for our pavement management plan. That's money that we've appropriated in the past to supplement state aid of $650,000. It puts $1 million into our roadway infrastructure. I'm very happy to state that over the past several years, including this past year, our pavement condition index has increased. So we're making very good use of those funds. There are two placeholders. One is for traffic calming elements, which I want to make a quick pitch. Tomorrow night at 7 p.m. at the high school is the public workshop to look at the Hayden Road traffic and pedestrian safety. So there's a placeholder for that. We don't know how much that will be. And a second placeholder, which was asked for by the chairman of the Permanent Building Committee, is $260,000. We had unforeseen subsurface conditions at the construction of the DPW facility, namely under the new salt shed. We found a boulder burial ground, which meant that we couldn't use the ridge and inclusions, and we have to modify the soil there in a different manner.
Okay.
I know I went over my time. I apologize.
The pressure's really going to be on Chief Lee. Anything?
Yeah, I saw a line item in here for the salt budget. I know typically we budget $200,000 a year, and that's one area where we're able to carry debt over from one year to another. And this year we're looking at $500,000. Why was that?
I think we level funded the snow and ice. Okay. Yeah.
Did I look at the wrong column or something?
I don't know, but we were very careful to level fund that, because if you don't level fund it, if you increase, you can not go down in your funding in the future.
Yeah, snow and ice is level funded at
$350,000. The microphone. Awesome. Snow and ice is level funded at $350,000.
I'm sorry, I'm looking at, okay, so it says snow and ice deficit to be raised on the first page. Final for 2017 was $200,000. Fiscal year 2018 from the town manager is requested $500,000.
In 19 projected is 500,000 going forward for the next 3 or 4 years.
Right.
This is on the.
It's on the very first
multiple year page.
Chris and I will take a look at that.
Yeah. The law is written such that you have to at least appropriate the minimum that you did the year before. This town has historically done that several years. If you go back, what that creates is it creates deficits at the end of the year, which we're illegally allowed to incur.
Right.
It's kind of hard. You have to pick how bad the winter's going to be. One thing that's undoubtedly clear is it gets increasingly expensive each year, given the same amount of snow. So,
not according to John. It's getting cheaper now.
We've made major reductions.
We'll take a look at that and see if we can.
John, do you guys still use the calcium? Or you're just straight going salt?
We use the road salt, and we also modify it. We spray it with liquid magnesium chloride, so that helps the melting process. It also helps the salt to stick to the road, so it doesn't get blown off, and it does its job.
So that's the treated, the super salt, the stuff that's.
We mix it at the spinner of the truck. We have tanks on the trucks. Yeah.
Anything else for the DPW director?
Just wanted to speak a little bit outside, but the meters, water meters.
Yes.
Are we going to step up because we keep falling behind every year doing the 10%, but with the new growth, we're falling behind. Are we going to invest in more meters and more people to change them over? Because changing over a meter, a 20-year-old meter, actually pays for itself in less than 3 years.
We do have an increase in our metering budget, and it's our intent to use our own staff to replace those meters.
Okay. Mr. Kamalo, anything else for the DPW?
Yeah, just to add on the last point, we have also applied for a grant that may augment our work around unaccounted for water supply.
Yes.
Thanks. That's big.
Next department, please.
Chief, because you're going last, you lose the two cruisers.
Is Chief, has everyone else shared their budget ideas, thoughts, concerns? Everybody comfortable before we get into the police department here? All right, Chief, 4 minutes, please.
Real quick, I'll go with dispatch first. We see an increase of 2.05%, which is $10,333. Basically, that is due to the CBA and contractual obligations. In salaries and overtime. for the dispatches, people moving up in steps. As for the police department, 78,368, 3.33%. That is also due to the collective bargaining agreement and contractual obligations. We also have $5,000 for the jail diversion program, which was paid for with a grant, but that grant has run out, and we knew when we signed up for it that we would be obligated in the future to pay $5,000. It's also an increase of one officer, where it's part of a strategic initiative that was identified before I was here. We held off prior year, we held off on putting a new officer on, and prior to that, we worked with adding a new lieutenant on the police department. As far as the capital request,
let's do this first. Mr. Sestari.
Can you just go over the numbers for central dispatch again?
How
much of an increase did you have?
10,333.
Okay, we're showing an increase of 22,000.
Department 214, right?
What page?
We don't really have page numbers here.
It's page four.
Yeah, that's about right.
Are we looking at an older spreadsheet here?
This is the one I got an email yesterday.
Yeah, Chief, I think the increase is 20,840. And this accounts for the increased number of part-timers.
Okay, sorry. We did hire several more part-timers to make up the difference with having two dedicated dispatchers at all times at this point.
Okay, so.
Oh.
Help me understand what's going on now?
Yeah. You will recall that when the communication center...
Obviously, I don't recall.
Yes. Hopefully, I'll help you in that regard. You will recall that when we consolidated the communication center, there was a staffing model that we worked on. And the success of that staffing model was based on a combination of full-timers with part-timers. And through the lessons that we have learned, it came to our attention that we needed to increase the part-timers. And hopefully, in the long term, that will reduce our overtime costs.
Okay.
Yeah.
So why is your number different than his number?
Yeah.
Yeah. We will look into that, Chief, because our numbers here show that it's a 4.34% increase in personal services.
Is that staffing model in place already? Is that staffing model in place already?
Yes.
Yeah, so I don't know why that would affect next year's budget.
If it's in place for FY17...
Then that would be part of the base.
Then that would be the base, is not an increase.
I'll tell you the details in 1 second.
I just want to see next year. We're converting the two part-timers to full-time.
So, I mean, I get the growth and I get the additional hours, whatever it is, because that's what we're all talking about, and that's what we have to recognize as taxpayers too. But I just want to make sure we have the same number. So,
Chief, just to be clear, I'm looking at the detailed worksheets here. The total personnel services is 501,026. And the difference between that and 480 is 20,000.
Yeah, my numbers are
up. Okay. Yeah. So you guys can sort that out in the next couple of days. Not a big deal. Just let's come back with the same number.
Sounds like the chief doesn't need that extra 10,000.
It's got 10 grand that we can give to the library. Okay. Chief, please continue.
On the capital, I did request three cruises for a total cost of $119,000, estimated cost of the Ford Interceptor utility, $39,734. Just following the schedule that we have followed over the last few years, actually, we're below the schedule. We've only asked for two cruises the last 2 years. We do have a situation now where we try to keep the vehicles under 80,000 miles. That is the recommended mileage for a police cruiser. It also helps us with the resale of the cruiser and insurance benefits.
There's a Blues Brothers vehicle right at the
right now,
Main Street Auto there. I love it. I want to buy that thing. You could drive that, Chief Frank.
And we're looking right now at 2016 because we're coming to kind of kicking the can down the road on the three vehicles. We'll have six vehicles above the 80,000. Two of the vehicles will be over 125,000. And five of the vehicles will be under the $100,000 powertrain warranty. So what we're doing is actually, maintaining and keeping up the fleet, continue our scheduling where we're not running cars 24/7, and getting the most out of the vehicles by resting them where other departments don't follow that schedule and run them into the ground.
Okay. Anything else? Questions, that's comments for the chief?
Chief, is there a government standard or a state standard on how often you replace a cruiser?
It's usually it's dictated by insurance companies premiums, but there's also for accreditation, and our federal accreditation is actually lower than the 80,000, but the state accreditation, which we're following, is 80,000.
It's followed. I think it's great. I mean, I have a family member that's in that business, and that town, they have take-home cruisers, and the fact that you're only asking for three cruisers for the amount of work that those things do all year is pretty good, whereas the other towns are, you're assigned your cruiser. I don't know how long they keep those cruisers, but I think it's good that if we can just stick with the three every year or two, that's
absolutely. We would be looking for three, two,
yep.
Three.
Mr. Catino.
Oh, I'm all set.
Mr. Cesari. Anything else for the chief?
Find out. I'm just kidding. I think we're all set. I think the part of the answer to Brendan's question is that the schedule we came up with was also an attempt to address some of the past years where we may have missed, replacing the cruisers. And I feel bad for the chief this year because he was expecting to purchase three additional cruisers, and we're pushing back and saying, given the directive from the board, perhaps the town can only afford two.
Okay. Yeah, I think in general we're going to obviously revisit everything a few times here as we work through this process, and maybe the capital improvements piece, we might have to set some numbers as targets to try and take a couple things here and there. I don't know yet. We'll see. But I think in general, the theme was kind of sort of reaffirmed tonight. The town's growing, our budgets are growing as a result, but we're saving $150 here, and we're adding up $446 there because there's a strong return on investment. And we've got some new dispatch folks over here, and whether it's $20,000 or $10,000, it all matters. We'll figure that little piece out. But there's things that have to happen to maintain the services we need in Hopkinton. So I think in general, it's been a very healthy exercise, and it's not the end of it. We may come back and say, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do it. I mean, we don't know yet. We're just kind of getting going here. And our colleagues on the school committee, who are 50% of the budget as well, and then we pull it all together to submit the 80 or 90 million, whatever it is, to town meeting. They're obviously still working their side too a little bit. Okay. With that, do you have anything else?
Just want to again thank the terrific team of department heads for their hard work getting us to this point. Most spectacularly, the work that you did over the last 2 weeks responding to the questions that came initially from the selectmen.
So when we have meetings like this and our colleagues are here until 10 o'clock at night, do we let them come in tomorrow morning after they have breakfast at home or whatever we do? I mean, how does that work? Do they have to be here at 7 a.m.?
And
Second. 7 a.m.
Words of Bill Belichick.
No, Dave. No time off.
Yeah, that was too funny.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Folks, thank you all for being here tonight. We apologize for keeping you over a little bit here, but really it does help us a lot. And we appreciate you sitting around a table and joining in the fun.
Thank you for the chocolates.
You're very welcome. Okay, we're going to move on here very quickly. Rapid fire process. Liaison reports. Mr. Ted Stone.
None for me.
Mr. Catino.
Last week, the chairman and I were at the EHOP spotlight on traffic and pedestrian safety. It was well attended, and a lot of good came out of that. And there's another one tomorrow night, as was mentioned earlier, the Hayden Row Corridor Traffic Calming Workshop with the EHOP educated opportunity people.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
Are you able to go to that tomorrow night?
Yeah.
I am not able to go to that one tomorrow night. So if you could encourage everybody to keep participating and perhaps get the town meeting, that would help.
Your comments are actually on here from the minutes.
Oh, good.
On the email.
Excellent.
Okay.
Saw that.
Sorry?
I saw your comments.
Oh, about the town meeting? Yeah. Mr. Starry.
Just Charter Review Committee had the town meeting. You guys were all there. You know the results.
Okay. Excellent.
Well done.
Mr. Kamalo or Mrs. Lazarus, any invites for the board coming up? I saw there's another scout, Eagle Scout ceremony coming up.
I didn't see that.
It's a Saturday in the winter, so I'd reply that I wouldn't be able to attend because of my kids.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, I think I haven't seen it.
Yeah, I think I saw where you were going to be able to attend, but we have that coming up. Any other invites?
We already mentioned the workshop tomorrow night.
Yeah.
To focus on Hayden Road traffic. There's also the invitation by the Massachusetts Sustainable Communities and Campuses Conference, March 17th, 2017.
Other events will be happening.
Yeah. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have something here. The Hopkin and Youth Commission, this is, I don't know if we missed it, but this is nothing that we talked about tonight, but it was in the packet. There's someone that has applied for the Hopkins.
There's a posting for a seat, Bill Maher.
Yeah.
I'm sure that could be a future agenda item.
Yeah, so we haven't got to it. It wasn't on tonight's agenda to appoint anyone to that.
Oh, okay.
So that would be an application for a future appointment.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else on invites? Mr. Kamal, town manager's report. Item number 11.
No additional reports for tonight. Wanted to focus on the budget.
Future board agenda items. Mr. Sestari.
Nothing.
Mr. Catino.
Nothing.
Mr. Tedstone.
I'm good.
Yeah. Chair will entertain a motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Aye. Good night, all. Thank you.
Great.